Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Hitler's Soldiers, the German Army in the Third Reich, by Ben H. Shepherd, narrated by Michael Page. Preface. Structure. This book tells the story of the German Army under the Third Reich. It examines the Army's military performance, its relationship with the Nazi regime, its role in military occupation, and its culpability in war crimes. The end of the Cold War saw the release of a vast range of primary sources. This more comprehensive base of information, now made available to Western historians, enabled better informed debate in this area, creating an outpouring of new scholarly literature on many aspects of the Second World War. The present book is the first general history of the German Army under the Third Reich to draw upon this new literature and the new perspectives it provides. The book takes a narrative approach to its subject. The first two chapters deal with the period 1933 to 1939. These chapters primarily consider the context of and build up to the main period on which the book focuses, that of the Second World War itself, during which all four of the book's concerns play central roles. Literature and sources. In keeping with its broad-based approach, the book draws primarily upon English language and German language secondary literature. For illustrative purposes, it also draws upon select primary sources, official German Army documents drawn from the Bundesarchiv Militärarchiv, BAMA, in Freiburg im Breisgau, excerpts from soldiers' letters, Feldpostbriefe, from the Bibliothek für Zeitgeschichte, BFZ, excerpts of both from various published collections and various former officers' memoirs. The selection of official documents consists largely of 1. Material produced by the German High Command and by larger field formations concerned with the troops' ideological and national political instruction, and 2. Material produced by a selection of German army divisions, together with the corps and army-level commands to which they were subordinate, covering issues such as combat, logistics, and the determinants of troop morale. Divisions were selected on the basis of the comprehensiveness of archival material pertaining to them, be they official sources or Feldpostbriefe. The divisions were also selected with a view to assembling a small representative sample of different types of army division. Hence, a small number of divisions frequently appear at various points in the narrative. The division that combines the most extensive sample of Feldpostbriefe with extensive official material is the 12th Panzer Division. Most of the letter excerpts that the book utilizes are drawn from the Sterz collection at the BFZ. The main reason for this was accessibility, for an extensive series of excerpts from the letters has been selected and listed by division, all for the benefit of researchers. Excerpts from the Schnepf collection, which the BFZ acquired only recently, have also been used. This is the first book to utilize material from this particular collection. Use of terms. The book refers to the German Army as the German Army, and not as the Wehrmacht. Whilst many works employ the term Wehrmacht to denote the German Army, this is actually incorrect. Wehrmacht directly translates as armed forces, and technically speaking, the Wehrmacht comprised not just the army, but also the Air Force, Luftwaffe, Navy, Kriegsmarine, and from 1944, the Waffen-SS. The term Wehrmacht is thus used to denote armed forces throughout the book. Other branches of the armed forces do receive attention throughout the book, however. This is particularly the case with the Waffen-SS, which fought and operated alongside the army, but also rivaled it for resources, and also with the Luftwaffe. The Luftwaffe features in the story in 3 respects. Like the Waffen-SS, it was both a fellow armed service for the army, but also a rival for manpower and resources. In addition, high-ranking Luftwaffe officers frequently acted as commanders of ground forces at army group level and above. In this capacity, they commanded large numbers of army troops. Online resources. Every effort has been made to provide fully accurate information throughout the book. Where any remaining updates are made following publication, these are listed in an online document accessible via the following site: gcu.ac.uk/gsbs/staff/drbenshepherd/. This site also provides access to scanned examples of primary sources used in this study, for the benefit of listeners interested in investigating such sources further. Introduction. 70 years after its collapse in 1945, the Third Reich remains a potent source of public and media fascination. Images of the Nazis' annual rallies at Nuremberg can still impress and horrify. The spectacle of Nazi troops and weaponry, orchestrated in vast, torch-lit arenas, seems to capture the essence of fascism: mindless obedience, servility, and military power. These same images, images that were designed to energize the German people and frighten Nazism's opponents at home and abroad, were staple ingredients of newspapers and newsreels around the world during the 1930s. For foreign observers to experience this display and to then see and hear the subsequent news reports as Germany overran its weaker neighbors during the late 1930s and early 1940s was to imbibe a terrifying impression of a country with an unstoppable war machine and an insatiable desire for expansion. The fear for European peoples especially was, when will they turn on us? Images designed to inspire the susceptible and terrify opponents even now have the power to chill, and for many people prompt the question, how could they lose? It was the German Wehrmacht, or armed forces, that achieved the Third Reich's spectacular military conquests, and above all other branches of the Wehrmacht, the Air Force, Luftwaffe, the Navy, Kriegsmarine, and later the militarized formations of the Waffen-SS, it was the German army that made the largest contribution. The German army, then, was the main sword arm of the Third Reich, of its national leader, Adolf Hitler, and of the ideology they espoused. Erwin Rommel, the most famous German general of the Second World War in Western eyes, affirmed this truth when he wrote in December 1938 that the army of the Wehrmacht is the sword of the new German worldview. The army and the Nazi movement did not come together overnight, yet Nazism and militarism were ideal partners, for warfare had a central place in Nazi ideology. This was due above all to the ideas of Hitler himself. There remains debate over just how important the different formative stages of Hitler's early life were to the development of his ideas. Certainly, two stages that did lay foundations for Hitler's racist, social Darwinist worldview were his time as a struggling artist-cum-drifter in Vienna between 1908 and 1913, and his service as a soldier of the Royal Bavarian Army on the Western Front between 1914 and 1918. Germany's defeat in 1918, the political chaos that blighted the country in its aftermath, and its subsequent humiliation in the Treaty of Versailles were events that all radicalized Hitler further. In 1919, he joined the German Workers' Party, DAP, shortly after it was renamed the National Socialist German Workers' Party, NSDAP, becoming its principal speaker before ascending to the post of party chairman in 1921. Hitler's writings during the 1920s espoused the then widely held belief that Germany had lost the war not in the field, but owing to a stab in the back inflicted by civilian leaders, communists, and Jews. Yet Hitler believed war was necessary not only to right this grave wrong, expand German territory, and restore Germany's status as a great power. Rather, these were all means to the same end to which Hitler believed wars should ultimately be fought: revitalizing and strengthening the German race itself. According to Hitler's worldview, war was a biological and political necessity if the German nation and German people were to thrive in an international order characterized by a perpetual struggle between races for domination. "I believe," he proclaimed in a speech of May 1928, "that I have enough energy to lead our people whither it must shed its blood, not for an adjustment of boundaries, but to save it into the most distant future by securing so much land and space that the future will receive back many times the blood shed." From the late 1920s onwards, economic crisis assailed the already fragile stability of the liberal democratic regime, the Weimar Republic, that had governed Germany since its defeat. From 1930 onwards, Hitler and the Nazis amassed enormous electoral support by attacking the Treaty of Versailles, appealing to Germans' sense of economic grievance and promoting pan-Germanism, anti-Semitism, and anti-communism. As Germany plunged ever deeper into political and economic chaos, Hitler became a key player in the country's politics. He co-opted a large chunk of Germany's conservative elite, the military leadership included, becoming Chancellor in 1933 and then National Leader, Führer, the following year. During the late 1930s, Germany flaunted its expansionist intent by seizing Austria and much of Czechoslovakia. These acts of annexation brought growing international concern and condemnation, but no military consequences. However, the invasion of Poland on 1 September 1939 finally led Britain, France, and the dominions of the British Commonwealth to declare war on Germany. In May and June 1940, the German army trounced the armies of France, Britain, and their allies in the West in a triumphant campaign, achieving in 6 weeks what its First World War predecessor had failed to achieve in 4 years. The army's tactical and operational performance completely outclassed that of its opponents, inflicting upon them the most spectacularly swift military humiliation in modern European history. Thanks to its efforts, together with those of the Luftwaffe and the Kriegsmarine, the Third Reich now dominated the European continent. Only Britain, together with her empire and Commonwealth, continued to resist in an apparently hopeless struggle. The superiority and triumph of German arms were conveyed in countless photographic and newsreel images. Among the most famous were German infantry storming across the River Meuse, panzers scything through opposition, Hitler and his entourage on a victorious sightseeing tour of Paris, and jubilant crowds hailing massed ranks of smartly attired troops in the Berlin Victory Parade of July 1940. Hitler's army appeared invincible. This astounding record of military success goes a long way to explaining why the German army of the Second World War still enjoys a reputation as the most proficient, effective fighting force to take the field of modern land combat. At the peak of its powers, so runs popular belief, the army combined peerless standards of training with unmatched expertise in armored warfare. The high point of the German army's achievements encompassed not only the swift crushing of France in the spring of 1940, but also, despite immense logistical challenges and a numerically superior enemy, the conquest of most of the European Soviet Union during the second half of 1941. Erich von Manstein, widely regarded as the army's finest general of the Second World War, attributed these achievements in his post-war memoir, Lost Victories, to the decisive factor of self-sacrifice, valor, and devotion to duty of the German fighting soldier, combined with the ability of commanders at all levels and their readiness to assume responsibility. These are the qualities which won us our victories. Whether or not this was the decisive factor, the causes of the army's success warrant serious investigation. Before asking how the German army eventually lost, then, we need to ask how it won, so repeatedly and spectacularly during the early years of the war. The qualities of the German soldier and the ability of commanders at all levels to think and act independently and effectively were indeed key to German victory. Yet further essential preconditions for the German army's victories lay in its size, organization, and technology. In every one of these respects, moreover, the German army also possessed weaknesses as well as strengths. It was the sum of the far greater weaknesses of its early opponents that further helped it to prevail. All these factors, too, then, warrant careful examination. The question of why the German army eventually lost is two questions in one. Why the army's string of triumphs was gradually brought to a halt, a process that was complete by the end of 1942 at the latest, and why it then suffered a succession of catastrophic defeats. The emphatic downturn in the army's military fortunes was apparent to all but its most delusional commanders by the summer of 1943, as defeats in North Africa and the Mediterranean, and most dramatically in the Soviet Union, placed it irrevocably on the defensive. The culprit, according to the post-war memoirs of Manstein and other former generals, was Hitler. When it came to Hitler's military failings, Manstein had plenty to say. What Hitler had lacked, Manstein claimed, was all sense of judgment regarding what could be achieved and what could not. Manstein also blamed his overestimation of the power of the will. In the face of his will, the essential elements of the appreciation of a situation on which every military commander's decision must be based were virtually eliminated. And with that, Hitler turned his back on reality. Manstein wasn't finished there, for he also claimed that this overestimation of his own willpower, this disregard for the enemy's resources and possible intentions, was not matched by a corresponding boldness of decision. The same man who, after his successes in politics up to 1938, had become a political gambler, actually recoiled from risks in the military field. Manstein partly put this down to Hitler's fears for his own prestige, his refusal to give up any piece of land he had captured, and a mind frame that conformed more to a mental picture of masses of the enemy bleeding to death before our lines than to the conception of a subtle fencer who knows how to make an occasional step backwards in order to lunge for the decisive thrust. According to Manstein, Hitler had also debilitated Germany's military performance thanks to a chaotic high command structure, one he himself had imposed to create clashes deliberately in order that he alone should at all times have the decisive say. Valid as all these criticisms may be, they contain not the slightest suggestion that the generals themselves, or the army's own basic structures and premises, may have been at least partly to blame for its degradation and eventual destruction. The German army was, in fact, debilitated not just by Hitler, but also by economic and organizational weakness and by the German army's leadership's regard, or rather disregard, for logistics, intelligence, and grand strategy. In time, the effects of all this fatally damaged the German army at the operational level. Much of the blame lies not just with Hitler, but also with the generals themselves. And just as the weaknesses and mistakes of the German army's early opponents were crucial to its early victories, so it is also important to examine closely the causes of Allied strength during the war's latter half. Manstein and other former generals attributed the Allies' eventual victory to their increasingly overwhelming superiority in manpower and material, particularly their strength in the air. But the causes of eventual Allied victory were more complex than simple brute force. A third question is how and why the army maintained its momentous struggle for so long. From 1943 onwards, the German army executed a fighting retreat of unparalleled tenacity against an increasingly formidable Red Army in the east and a Western Allied coalition powered increasingly by the economic and military might of the United States. It did so to the mounting ruin of itself, its homeland, and Nazism's victims across occupied Europe, long after all plausible hope of victory had evaporated. For Manstein, the how was attributable to those same qualities of self-sacrifice, valor, devotion to duty, and proficiency of command that had won the German army its victories. These alone enabled us to face the overwhelming superiority of our opponents. Yet these are only part of the answer. That the Allied armies did not advance as smoothly and proficiently as they might have done was also due to their own deficiencies. The German army was also able to fight on against them for darker reasons, about which, unsurprisingly, Manstein had similarly little to say. Just one example was the increasingly terroristic discipline that it inflicted upon its own troops. All three of these initial questions concern the German army's fighting power. For many years after the Second World War, the talk among military scholars in the West was all of the superior qualities that the German army and its troops had displayed between 1939 and 1945. Much of this was due to the Cold War, a setting in which both German-speaking and English-speaking scholars, students, and general readers of military history had an interest in eulogizing the German army. This was because the army of the Liberal Democratic Federal Republic of West Germany, the Bundeswehr, was both a NATO ally and the successor to the German army of the Third Reich. Moreover, the former German generals who now eulogized their old army had had experience of fighting in the Soviet Union. Readers in the West thus took an even greater interest in what they were saying. They took a greater interest still because the ex-generals were conveying a version of the German army's story during the Second World War that maintained that quality could prevail against quantity. This, of course, was an attractive message for readers in the West, not to mention NATO planners, who contemplated the possibility of a conventional war between NATO and the numerically superior forces of the Warsaw Pact. The end of the Cold War brought the slaying of some scholarly sacred cows, and new opportunities for scholars to tap into a wealth of material in the countries of the former Soviet bloc. For these reasons, it provided an opportunity to scrutinize the performance of the German army and its allied opponents in a more detailed and objective way. As to why the overwhelming bulk of the army continued to defend a criminal regime leading its country to destruction, rather than turn on that regime as a few courageous officers eventually tried to do, Manstein's memoirs said very little. At his trial for war crimes in 1949, he stated, "No senior military commander can for years on end expect his soldiers to lay down their lives for victory and then precipitate defeat by his own hand." But that was saying very little also. And with reason, for swaths of the army, most prominently the bulk of its senior commanders, were to varying degrees culpable for the Nazi regime's crimes. Following the Third Reich's collapse in 1945, newsreels that had once conveyed German military might now conveyed the criminal horrors perpetrated by the Third Reich in pursuit of its goals. In addition to its peerless reputation as a fighting force, another element of the German army's popular image is as a body of men who managed to distance themselves from these horrors, men who fought for their country out of patriotic duty rather than Nazi fanaticism, remaining aloof from the Nazi regime and untainted by its crimes. It was claimed, in other words, that while Germany's reputation was blackened by the Nazis, and particularly by their ideological and criminal vanguard, the SS, the German army had generally fought correctly and retained its honor. Certainly, a multitude of former generals, including Manstein, insisted in their post-war memoirs that they had had no truck with those utterly unsoldierly criminal orders with which the regime had furnished them, orders that, had they then transmitted them to their own men, would have threatened not only the honor of our fighting troops, but also their morale. The fact that this viewpoint was generally swallowed in the West after the Second World War was partly due, again, to the Cold War. During the 1960s, however, West German scholars began to challenge this viewpoint, just as a new young generation of West Germans was challenging the Nazi associations that it believed had tainted its parents' generation. The end of the Cold War brought a further surge in scholarship. This was due, again, to the opening of new archival sources. From the 1980s, moreover, the wartime generation began to retire from the scene, and in more recent years is increasingly departing from it altogether. Although it is poignant to contemplate the passing of a generation, where the scholarship of the Third Reich is concerned, it has undoubtedly created space for freer debate and more critical study. Decades of more recent scholarship have now demolished the image of the clean Wehrmacht. No serious account of the German army during the Nazi period can any longer avoid concluding that it was complicit in abhorrent crimes. Indeed, it was also callously ruthless in the pursuit of its own military objectives. This was not only because Nazi ideology permeated the German army far more extensively than Manstein and his ilk would ever have admitted. It was also because of a mixture of utilitarian calculation, ruthless military attitudes, and sometimes brutalizing pressure of circumstances. Yet it is also important to acknowledge and investigate why some soldiers, units, and higher commands were more complicit than others, and indeed how far and why others still may not have been complicit at all. All this raises a fourth imperative question, of how the army could behave in this way and of how far. This introduction, then, has so far posed four broad questions concerning the conduct, achievements, and failures, both moral and military, of the German army under the Third Reich. The answers lie in examining the history of the army and its personnel, their strategy and operations, their tactics and technology, and their morality and ideology. But a prefacing question concerns just what caused the German army to align with Nazism in the first place. This question underpins all the others, and it is one to which this introduction now turns. The officer corps of the German Empire of 1871 to 1918 was dominated by the highly conservative Prussian officer corps. Prussia had been the most powerful of the individual kingdoms that unified as the new empire following the Franco-Prussian War. The traditional mainstays of the Prussian officer corps were the sons of Protestant clerics, of senior civil servants, and above all of the aristocratic and landowning Junker class, whose ancestral home lay in the lands east of the River Elbe. The ethos of the imperial officer corps made three particular demands upon its members. The first was unquestioning loyalty to the state. The second was that officers disengage from the complexities of German politics and society. Such an environment inevitably made officers more distrustful of any group, particularly of Jews and socialists, who were outside the conservative nationalist mainstream. The cultural climate of the officer corps did not entirely muffle more enlightened attitudes. For instance, the officer corps of the comparatively liberal southern German state of Württemberg was more accepting of Jews. But within such a socially and politically conservative institution as the wider officer corps, liberal influences were marginal at most. Extending membership of the officer corps to patriotic bourgeois circles during the late 19th century did not change this. All this sapped officers' moral and political faculties to such an extent that, when they finally contemplated either aligning themselves with Nazism or recoiling from it, most of them fatefully chose the former. The third demand, which followed directly from the second, was an almost myopic focus on soldiering. Here, the arch-conservatives who headed the officer corps made one concession to change. They knew a modern mass army needed a large, technically proficient officer corps. After all, the growth of industry, technology, and populations across Europe during the decades before the First World War meant that armies were becoming not just larger, but also, with advances in firepower, transportation, and communications, not to mention the rise of air power, more technocratic. Indeed, this was a major reason why the officer corps needed to widen its membership. But it nevertheless remained fixated on the narrow business of soldiering, tactics and operations, albeit in a technically updated form. This made it proficient at winning small engagements, battles, and indeed campaigns. But officer cadets were taught little, if anything, about the wider means by which wars are won. Economic resources, logistics, international diplomacy, high-level intelligence, and, above all, strategy. It would prove to be a particular conceit of the German officer corps during both world wars to believe that its superior tactical and operational performance could overcome Germany's acute strategic weaknesses. Those officers holding senior command positions in the Third Reich broadly belonged to one of two generations. The elder, born primarily during the 1870s and 1880s, hailed largely from the conservative aristocratic mainstay of the Prussian officer corps. The future senior commanders who belonged to this group predominantly served as junior and middle-ranking staff officers during the First World War. The second group, much larger and less aristocratic in origin, had mainly been born during the 1890s and mainly served on the front line during the First World War. This was the Frontkämpfer-Generation. The war had a profoundly hardening effect upon both groups of officers. The effect was especially profound among those who experienced the industrial-scale carnage of the Western Front in Belgium and northern France. The staff officers of the First World War also drew broader but equally harsh conclusions as to how future wars were to be won, believing that victory in modern industrialized war would go to whichever side most effectively mobilized the sum total of its technological, economic, and human resources. This included not just military personnel, but also civilian populations, whether in Germany or in its occupied territories. Such officers embraced the total, all-encompassing nature of modern industrialized warfare as surely as their frontline colleagues did. They also came to ascribe central importance to effective propaganda, iron discipline on home front and battlefront, and suppression of defeatist elements. Indeed, many of the officers who would later hold high command under the Third Reich perceived acute danger from defeatist elements, whether real or imagined, as they sought scapegoats for the grueling stalemate that bedeviled Germany's war effort from late 1914 onwards. Such officers were overlooking Germany's fundamental strategic handicap. For most of the First World War, the Germans were condemned to a fight on two fronts against an enemy coalition with superior economic resources and to a British naval blockade that denied them resources and precipitated widespread starvation among the German population. They also overlooked the failings of the German high command. a body whose inept grasp of high-level logistics, international diplomacy, and, above all, strategy, worsened Germany's plight immeasurably. For instance, the High Command's reckless effort to blockade Britain with a campaign of unrestricted submarine, U-boat warfare hit U.S. shipping hard and played the greatest role in antagonizing the United States into the war on the Allied side in 1917. Similarly inept were the High Command's efforts to overcome the British blockade through more effective production and distribution of food. In unison with right-wing civilian nationalists, army officers' search for scapegoats for Germany's waning military fortunes fixed not upon their own High Command, but upon civilians, democratically minded domestic politicians whose commitment to the war they deemed too feeble, socialists who they believed were actively undermining the war effort, and Jews. Many officers believed Jews were disproportionately represented among both politicians and socialists, and, echoing centuries-old forms of anti-Semitism, that Jewish businessmen, black marketeers, and swindlers were capitalizing on the human misery the war was causing. A particularly noxious belief that arose following the 1917 Bolshevik Revolution in Russia was that Jews were the puppet masters of Bolshevism. Indeed, the political condition of Germany during the second half of the First World War hardened anti-Semitic prejudices across much of German society, as well as within the officer corps. The idea that an infernal Jew-Bolshevik intelligentsia ran the new revolutionary Russian state was one to which many army officers, and even more ardently, the Nazis, would eventually subscribe. Yet the list of enemies in the German army officers' fear-filled imaginings during and after the First World War went beyond Jews and Bolsheviks. Fighting on the Eastern Front also intensified many officers' anti-Slavic prejudices. These were founded on centuries of antagonism between Germans and their Eastern neighbors, and more recently on fears about the expansion of Tsarist Russia. Indeed, it was these fears that had helped to impel the German High Command towards war in 1914. Anti-Russian sentiments were further stoked by the atrocities the Russian army inflicted upon German civilians during its brief invasion of East Prussia in August 1914. Many officers also experienced the primitive conditions of the westernmost territory of Russia at a formative time in their lives through direct violent encounter with the backward East between 1915 and 1918. When Germany was forced to sue for peace in November 1918, virtually all the officers who would eventually comprise the leadership of Hitler's army believed that the soldiers of the Kaiser's army had been undone by defeatism, spread by cowardly or seditious groups on the home front. But this was putting the chicken before the egg, for German civilians had lost their will to continue the war largely because they knew that the German army, though still fighting in autumn 1918, was ultimately going to be undone on the front line. Regardless, the stab in the back became a potent myth among army officers, as indeed it did among the nationalist right in Germany. Such officers were hardly going to be enamored of the new democratic regime, the Weimar Republic, which replaced the now defunct imperial regime. Then, following national defeat and the Kaiser's abdication, Germany was shaken by violent upheaval. Radical left-wing forces inspired by the Bolshevik Revolution in Russia tried to seize power across Central Europe. The vulnerable new Social Democrat-led government in Germany was forced to call upon units of the army and the right-wing vigilante Free Corps, to suppress the revolts that had sprung up in various German towns and cities. This they did with brutal efficiency, and often, in the case of the Freikorps, bloodthirsty abandon. It was during this period that the contempt for socialism that many officers felt turned to hatred of Bolshevik revolution. Moreover, such was the link many drew between Jews and the far left that it further hardened their anti-Semitic prejudices. Coupled with the harsh lessons many officers drew from the First World War was the bitter resentment they felt at the terms of the Treaty of Versailles, imposed upon their defeated nation in 1919. The treaty imposed massive financial reparations, reduced Germany's landmass, demilitarized the Rhineland, thus forbidding Germany from stationing troops along much of its western frontier, stripped Germany of its overseas colonies, and saddled it with all the guilt for causing the war in the first place. For the army, three of the treaty's terms were especially galling. The army was reduced to a dwarf 100,000-man body, the Reichswehr. the elite general staff, which had directed Germany's military policy and operations since 1871, was disbanded. Finally, much of the ancestral land of the traditional Junker officer class was ceded to the newly created state of Poland, or cut off from the rest of Germany by the new Polish corridor. The Reichswehr leadership did not just seize helplessly at all this. It looked to a time when Germany would be able once more to rearm openly, create a larger, genuinely powerful army, and win back its position of power on the international stage. The Reichswehr leadership asserted, and indeed the civilian defense ministry accepted, that war would be a necessary part of this process. In 1926, the Truppenamt, Troops Office, a new planning body designed covertly to continue the work of the old general staff, issued a memorandum stating that Germany would need to reoccupy the Rhineland and secure the return of Upper Silesia, the Saar, and the Polish corridor. This, the Truppenamt predicted, would precipitate conflict with France, Belgium, Poland, Czechoslovakia, and possibly Italy. All necessary, it believed, if Germany was to reclaim its continental and eventually world power status. These immensely ambitious plans were based on the assumption that, with the right conditions and the right means, Germany could win a series of short, sharp wars over its opponents, just as Prussia had done during the wars of German unification between 1864 and 1871. The plans took no account of how powerful this potential array of opponents might be, or of the allegiances it might forge with major powers further afield. This, then, was a further legacy of the stab-in-the-back myth. The myth absolved Germany's military leadership from needing to engage with the broader strategic reasons for its defeat in the First World War. In doing so, it also made the military leadership more likely to identify the wrong formula, founded on the German army's tactical and operational talents, for future victory. The particular lessons the Reichswehr drew from Germany's defeat led it to devise a three-pronged strategy, one that it believed would enable the country to triumph in a future war. The first prong involved developing new tactics and weaponry, and through them, concepts for successful military operations. The Reichswehr leadership was determined covertly to circumvent the Versailles Treaty's armaments provisions. Indeed, among other things, it established a clandestine armored warfare training school in collaboration with the Red Army of the Soviet Union. The conservative Reichswehr and the communist Red Army may have seemed strange bedfellows, but they found common cause as the armies of nations that were international lepers for most of the 1920s. Denied contact with other foreign armies, they pooled their expertise and resources to considerable mutual benefit. The Reichswehr was also determined to secure the best possible human material for its officers and rank-and-file troops, train them to exceptional standards, and attain a level of tactical and technical proficiency unmatched by any other army of the period. The drastic reduction in the size of the German officer corps would greatly aid this endeavor. Though its expansion before and during the First World War had reduced the dominance of the aristocratic Junker landowning class, its diminished size now enabled it to be socially selective again. Much more importantly, it now became not just a social elite, but also a professional one. This smaller, streamlined officer corps was able to jettison a great deal of dead wood and become more proficient in the process. The rise of the military technocrat, the specialist in mass destruction, was an international phenomenon during the interwar years, but it was especially pronounced within the Reichswehr. Smarting from defeat and humiliation, the Reichswehr officer corps felt particularly spurred to excel at its craft, the more so as it absorbed a new generation of young officers eager for professional advancement. The Truppenamt was at the forefront of these efforts. Over the course of the 1920s, it aimed to combine the technical and organizational prowess of the old general staff with the destructive power of industrialized, mechanized warfare. Forbidden by the Versailles Treaty to develop an armored force, the Reichswehr initially practiced armored maneuvers using wooden contraptions mounted on tricycles. Comical though the spectacle was, the intention was deadly serious, and the Reichswehr eventually developed an unrivaled proficiency in armored warfare tactics. The most important Reichswehr armored maneuvers took place in 1928, 1930, and in particular 1932. On the latter occasion, the Reichswehr outdid all those other armies who actually possessed an armored warfare capability when its maneuvers experimented with radio as a means of improving command and control. This would greatly improve communication on the battlefield and eventually give the panzers a clear advantage over their armored opponents during the first 2 years of the Second World War. The essence of the Reichswehr's armored doctrine was not new, but born of older principles embedded in the Prussian-dominated military culture of the German army. Prussian military doctrine had been developing since the 17th century, reaching its apogee in the wars of German unification. It preached rapid and aggressive maneuver, concentrated attack on the opposing army's weak spots, and breakthrough to defeat and destroy its forces decisively. The revolution in defensive firepower and fortifications during the years before the First World War had rendered attack prohibitively costly and precipitated the stalemate of the Western Front. Offensive-minded Prussian-style operational doctrine was now rendered temporarily redundant. But by 1917, German units in the field were developing a new suite of tactics, stormtroop tactics, which would restore movement and effective offensive firepower to the battlefield. It was to these tactics that the Truppenamt would turn during the 1920s. Stormtroop tactics were a bottom-up phenomenon, originating in German victories on the Italian and Eastern fronts in 1917. A brief but heavy bombardment, mixing gas shells and high explosives, aimed at maximum disruption by targeting enemy headquarters and communications rather than the troops in the trenches. The stormtroops then raced forward in independently operating squads, bristling with wire cutters, light artillery, light machine guns, grenades, and flamethrowers, equipment designed to enable them swiftly to break into and then through the enemy's lines. Such tactics succeeded not simply because the stormtroops were effective, but because they coordinated the stormtroops with artillery, follow-up infantry, and pioneers in an effective combined arms operation. Disastrously for the Germans, stormtroops were unable to achieve decisive victory on the Western Front in the spring and early summer of 1918. They faced well-resourced British, French, and US forces who coordinated their defense with great skill and resilience. The Allies then steadily pushed the Germans back through the late summer and autumn in a series of combined arms operations of their own. These operations, unlike those of the Germans, were able to employ tanks and air power. But Reichswehr armored warfare specialists of the 1920s believed that replacing stormtroops with tanks, panzers, combining them with air power and other troop branches, and coordinating the whole according to Prussian-style operational art could prove a recipe for rapid and decisive victory in the future. To ensure that both its frontline officers and more senior commanders would be equal to the task of conducting offensive mobile warfare, Reichswehr doctrine and training promoted Auftragstaktik, or mission tactics, a concept that had suffused Prusso-German military thinking since the 19th century. Although contemporaries and historians debated and continue to debate the exact meaning of the term, a recent extensive study drew on German military training manuals from the period 1871 to 1914 to maintain that Auftragstaktik was a complex approach with several interdependent elements to the increasingly unpredictable conditions of the battlefield. The officer who practiced it successfully would be decisive, independently minded, and offensively minded. This did not mean, however, that he could defy orders and lunge in any direction he wanted. He would lead his own men with authority, but would also obey his superiors, recognize the wider operation's goal, and, perhaps most importantly, be able to judge and respond to a particular battlefield situation in whatever way served that goal most effectively. Manstein conveyed this particular idea effectively in his memoirs, writing, "The granting of such independence to subordinate commanders does, of course, presuppose that all members of the military hierarchy are imbued with certain tactical or operational axioms. Only the school of the German General Staff can, I suppose, be said to have produced such a consistency of outlook." Officers could get the mix wrong, though they often got away with it and indeed sometimes plucked victory from peril. A classic example was General Hermann von Francois, a corps commander in the German 8th Army, which fought the Russian invasion of East Prussia in 1914. During that campaign, François first managed, through his own recklessness, to ruin a careful plan to ambush and destroy the Russian First Army, but then played a starring role in annihilating the Russian Second Army. The Second World War would produce numerous examples of such commanders. Essentially, however, the officer who mastered Auftragstaktik was the officer who employed the right mix of all the aforementioned qualities to suit the particular battlefield situation. Reichswehr doctrine also applied Auftragstaktik to defensive warfare. Such was the Reichswehr's numerical weakness that it could not hope to hold its first line of defense were Germany to be invaded. Instead, it instructed delayed resistance, essentially a fighting retreat from the first line of defense that would take advantage of the troops' maneuverability and flexibility. The second element in the Reichswehr's strategy was to get the nation physically organized for war, particularly through effective control of the economy. Of course, putting the German economy on a war footing could not be done covertly, and the Versailles Treaty hugely restricted what it could achieve on this front. But this reality did not stifle the Reichswehr's ambitions, and in 1924 it established a Wirtschaftsstab, economic staff. The Wirtschaftsstab's task was to forge strong links with German industry and make plans to develop a true defense economy, or Wehrwirtschaft. Finally, the Reichswehr leadership sought the kind of national leadership that would fortify the morale of both troops and civilians over the course of a future war. This, like the true defense economy officers longed for, required a regime that genuinely shared the Reichswehr's goals and stood ready to mobilize the German people in their cause. For almost all officers, the Weimar Republic was not that regime. By contrast, Wilhelm Groener, a former general and then national defense minister between 1928 and 1932, angered right-wing circles by accepting in principle that the country's democratically elected leaders could control the Reichswehr's development and deployment. Groener also took a much more measured view than most senior officers about what the Reichswehr's goals should be. He believed Germany should avoid ventures beyond its military means and recognized that it needed international cooperation in order to survive. Groener particularly recognized that because Germany was reliant upon U.S. loans to pay off its war reparations, it was hardly going to be in a position to fight France. But when the USA withdrew its loans during the economic crisis that followed the Wall Street crash of 1929, any hope for internationalist moderation from the Reichswehr leadership evaporated. As unemployment in Germany eventually soared to 8 million, the Weimar party system was pulled to both extremes as the Communist Party of Germany, Kommunistische Partei Deutschlands, or KPD, and the Nazis soaked up votes from the mainstream parties, and communists clashed bloodily with the brown-shirted stormtroopers of the Nazis' paramilitary wing, the SA, Sturmabteilung, or Storm Section. Governments became increasingly untenable and short-lived, however many emergency decrees they might try to govern by. As the economic and political mayhem unfolded, the Reichswehr leadership steamed ahead with its three-pronged strategy. Now more than ever, it wished to see liberal democracy in Germany killed off and replaced with a regime more akin to itself. Initially, the Reichswehr leadership considered a conservative authoritarian dictatorship, but it knew such a dictatorship required sufficient popular support to govern. This was something the Reichswehr could not command, either on its own or through the short-lived authoritarian chancellorships of Franz von Papen and General Kurt von Schleicher in 1932. By this time, the Reichswehr leadership was contemplating an alliance with the only political party that appeared to have the potential both to command popular support and to stop the communists, the Nazis. Many of the Reichswehr's conservative-minded, most senior officers had serious doubts about the Nazi movement, particularly the left-wing economic radicalism of some of its elements and the brutal, unruly thuggery of the SA. Yet the Nazis had long trumpeted their belief in militarizing German society. And a growing number of senior officers were coming to believe that the Nazis offered the only viable key to gaining mass support, mobilizing the German people for war, inspiring popular feeling among the vast majority, and suppressing any dissenting minority that might spread the kind of defeatism that had allegedly wrecked the German war effort in 1918. Such officers reasoned that under the Nazis, the German people would be inculcated with militaristic values, support the army's expansion and technological renewal, and imbibe the nationalistic spirit necessary for Germany to wage a future war successfully. Lieutenant General Werner von Blomberg, writing as Hitler's Minister for War 18 months after the Nazis took power, proclaimed, "A commitment to nationalism is the clear basis of all military activity. We must not forget, however, that the ideology that shaped the new state is not only nationalist, but National Socialist. National Socialism derives the basis for its actions from the vital necessities of the whole nation and from the duty of working together for the totality of the nation. It is founded on the idea of the community of blood and fate of all Germans. There is no dispute about the fact that this law is and must remain the basis for the service of the German soldier." Finally, on 30 January 1933, the aged Field Marshal Paul von Hindenburg, the last president of the Weimar Republic, appointed Hitler Chancellor of Germany. More conservative senior officers were reassured that Hitler had at least agreed to head a cabinet whose members were mostly traditional conservatives themselves, men who, presumably, would keep the Nazis' more extreme elements in check. Events would, of course, unfold in a vastly different way. Part 1. Military Ascent, Moral Decline. Chapter 1. The Army in the New Reich, 1933-1936. During their first 18 months in power, the Nazis destroyed the existing German constitution and with it all sources of opposition, real or potential. They began incarcerating opponents and other undesirables in a growing network of concentration camps. In June 1934, Hitler wiped out a swath of political opponents, then declared himself Führer upon President Hindenburg's death 2 months later. The army leadership, passively and sometimes actively, aided and abetted this entire process. It also increasingly subordinated itself to the Nazi regime. It did so not just for the military, political, and, for some officers, ideological reasons, according to which it had allowed the Nazis into power in January 1933, but also because of the phenomenal expansion of the army that the regime brought about. In 1933, the German army was a 100,000-man Reichswehr. By 1936, it contemplated a future wartime force of 2.6 million men, half a million more than the German army in 1914. Such breakneck expansion transformed it into a true people's army, diluted the conservative character of the officer corps, and made the army as a whole more subject to National Socialist influence. Driving this expansion was Hitler's hugely ambitious program of foreign and military policy. To the German public and the international community, Hitler presented a forceful yet peaceful image. His objective, he claimed, was to abolish the provisions of the Treaty of Versailles, restore to Germany its military power and its rightful place among the great nations, and unify the German-speaking peoples of Europe. He did not publicly reveal, though anyone familiar with his writings of the 1920s would have known it, that these were only the first steps in a foreign policy grand design of immense radical ambition. The inspiration for this design lay in Hitler's Darwinian conviction that waging war and conquering foreign territory for living space, Lebensraum, were essential to the German people's continued vitality and to their victory in the struggle for domination among nations and races. An essential precondition of this, Hitler believed, was to indoctrinate the German people with National Socialist thinking and a correspondingly warlike mentality. The Nazis would found a racial community, a Volksgemeinschaft, that, at least according to the rhetoric, would cut across all social and economic divides and unify all Germans fulfilling the right racial, social, and political criteria. Nazi social and economic policies and Nazi propaganda, Hitler proclaimed, would engender pride in the Volksgemeinschaft and in the German nation. In particular, the Nazi regime would indoctrinate future German soldiers through propaganda, youth groups, the education system, and the new Reich Labor Service, Reichsarbeitsdienst, or RAD, while the armed forces would complete the process by training and further indoctrinating the troops themselves. More generally, the Nazis would work to instill a militaristic, warlike pride within the German people as a whole. The Nazis certainly had cause to feel optimistic on this particular score, for they were operating against a long-standing backdrop of popular militarism across much of German society. The Weimar years had seen a proliferation of veterans' associations and a mushrooming of best-selling war-orientated literature. Hitler foresaw the next stage of German expansion as making Central Europe a key area of German domination and economic exploitation. This would require a final reckoning with France, which had constructed an alliance system across Central Europe, a reckoning that would also bring the even greater long-term benefit of destroying France as a great power rival. This in turn would clear the way for the most important phase of Hitler's foreign policy program, the push to capture Lebensraum and vast economic resources in Eastern Europe and the Soviet Union. And there is much to indicate that Hitler would not have stopped there, that he would have used the economic resources of a German-dominated Europe as a basis for truly global power. This would have brought Germany into war with the United States, and, if she refused to engage with the new global order, with Britain also. Three of the most important army figures during the period between 1933 and 1936 were Lieutenant General Werner Freiherr von Fritsch, Commander-in-Chief of the Army from February 1934, Major General Ludwig Beck, Chief of the Truppenamt between 1933 and 1935, before becoming head of the new Army General Staff, and, most importantly, General von Blomberg, whom Hitler appointed Minister for War in his new cabinet from January 1933. In May 1935, Blomberg became Commander-in-Chief of the Armed Forces, the Wehrmacht. Fritsch was a socially detached bachelor, immensely diligent and respected. He also detested Jews and Democrats, making his feelings clear since the early 1920s with a directness remarkable for a serving senior officer. In 1924, he had written that Ebert, the President of the Republic, pacifists, Jews, Democrats, and the French are all the same thing, namely the people who want to destroy Germany. All this, of course, made it easier for him to work with the Nazis. Beck was a strong advocate of rearmament and national expansion, but he was also shrewd. During the early years of the Third Reich, while the rebuilding German armed forces remained too weak to contemplate offensive action, he was instrumental in planning defensive strategies in the event of war, and in promoting Germany's defensive security in the meantime. A first step towards creating greater defensive security, though it necessitated some nose-holding by officers of Junker stock, was the non-aggression pact Germany signed with Poland in 1934. In the longer term, Beck believed Germany should rearm enough to deter Britain and France from trying to prevent a new German hegemony in Central Europe. He was also convinced of France's long-standing intention to keep Germany in a permanent state of subjugation, writing that France stands in the way of every extension of German power, and should for this reason be seen as Germany's firm enemy. Only later would the far more alarming scale of Hitler's foreign policy ambitions become clear to Beck. Blomberg was not an out-and-out Nazi, but he was prone to romantic, indeed naive, political notions, and was easily influenced. A visit to the Soviet Union in the 1920s, for instance, left him highly impressed by communism. Here, he perceived, was a totalitarian political system that had granted its armed forces enormous power and prestige. It, the Red Army, lacked for little, he later recalled, and I nearly came home a consummate Bolshevik. Blomberg became convinced that Nazism would do the same for the armed forces in Germany, and set about assimilating the armed forces with the Nazi regime with an almost giddy enthusiasm. Among other things, he ordered that military uniforms display Nazi symbols, military personnel greet one another with the Nazi Heil when in civilian attire, and the army hold weekend courses to train SA stormtroopers as border guards. Blomberg would take assimilation to even greater lengths from 1935 onwards. Spurring on Blomberg in all this was Colonel Walter von Reichenau, the ambitious head of Blomberg's ministerial office. On his appointment to the latter post in February 1933, he declared, "Our path leads forwards, which means join the new state and claim the position that is our due." Many of Reichenau's army colleagues scorned his bumptious manner and thrusting careerism. They also derided the obsequious enthusiasm with which Blomberg applied himself to enmeshing the army in the new regime, nicknaming him the Gummilöwe, or Rubber Lion. Yet while many in the army's senior officer corps harbored reservations about the Nazis, precious few behaved accordingly. Indeed, many aristocratic officers derided Blomberg's closeness to the largely middle-class Nazi leadership, not because they were anti-Nazi, but because they were snobs. At this stage, only a small number of senior army officers were committed Nazis, but many aged between about 40 and 50, most of whom had been Frontkämpfer during the First World War, were particularly exhilarated at the opportunities the new regime offered. Technically minded officers such as Lieutenant Colonel Heinz Guderian, aged 44 when the Nazis came to power, were dazzled at the prospect of developing and commanding an expanded, technically cutting-edge army. The Nazis' espousal of all things military and the fact that their own leadership numbered so many war veterans also helped them win the approval of many Frontkämpfer among the senior officer corps. Harder to convince were the older, most senior officers, such as General of Infantry Gerd von Rundstedt and Lieutenant General Fedor von Bock. Such men belonged to that group born between the mid-1870s and mid-1880s, who had served mainly as staff officers during the First World War. As a socially homogeneous group, hailing predominantly from aristocratic Prussian stock, they held the officer corps' traditionally conservative attitudes. They longed for Germany to regain its great power status, but were deeply uneasy about the Nazi movement's revolutionary elements. On the other hand, they tended from the start to blame the regime's early excesses on extreme Nazi elements rather than on Hitler. Moreover, older officers, like many of their younger colleagues, already widely shared Nazi ideology's disdain for Slavs, Bolsheviks, and Jews, even if they felt it less intensely than the Nazis themselves did. When in February 1933 and again in February 1934, Hitler conveyed to the army's most senior officers his long-term ambition of waging a racial war in the East, they did not take his utterances especially seriously. Major General Maximilian Freiherr von Feichs would go on to command army groups in southern Russia and the Balkans during the Second World War. He transcribed Hitler's words at the February 1934 meeting, later recalling, "The soldier was used to taking a politician's words not entirely seriously. To justify his political aims, he often selects aspects that don't correspond to his true intentions." But neither did the generals recoil from the vision Hitler was presenting to them. According to Weichs, these sinister intimations were probably soon forgotten, and the officer corps as a whole did believe the Nazi regime would infuse the German people with the unified militaristic spirit that it would need to stay the course in a future war. Hitler also directed at the officer corps copious rhetoric about the army being the second pillar of the new Nazi state alongside the Nazi party. Officers lapped this up, acceded to a process that would in fact see the army increasingly subordinated to the Nazi regime. The officer corps deluded themselves all the more easily because of the resources showered upon the army and upon the armed forces generally during the regime's early years. The first key announcement as to how much cash was to be allocated to rearmament seems to have come in June 1933. The annual allocation of about 4.4 billion Reichsmarks eclipsed the hundreds of millions the Weimar Republic had spent annually. And 4.4 billion Reichsmarks was just the start. In 1935, the armed forces' share of government expenditure rose to 73%. Big business bought into the Nazi economic program, albeit with some reservations, partly because rearmament promised enormous profits and business opportunities, partly because the Nazis had obligingly destroyed the trade unions, and partly because the Nazis were able to manipulate big business by divide and rule, particularly co-opting those sections of commerce and industry that had most to gain from rearmament. Initially, rearmament was to be financed secretly through loans granted by the various large companies that stood to gain from it. Blomberg was allowed to bypass the finance ministry, present his demands to a three-man committee, and, if he did not get his way, go straight to Hitler. The regime also spent far more on rearmament than on civilian work creation schemes. Even ostensibly non-military projects had a military use. For instance, the new network of Autobahnen, motorways, on which work commenced soon after the Nazis assumed power, would be able to convey 300,000 troops from east to west within 2 days. From March 1935, Hitler would stop rearming secretly and announce his intentions openly. Meanwhile, the Nazi movement faced an internal power struggle, one that would entangle and then taint the army leadership. The struggle was between the leadership of the SA, particularly Chief of Staff Ernst Röhm, on the one hand, and the army leadership, other conservative elites and Röhm's rivals in the Nazi movement, on the other. The stormtroopers' thuggery towards the Nazis' opponents had been immensely useful when the Nazis were campaigning for power. Now that they had reached their goal, however, the stormtroopers were becoming a lawless, destabilizing element on German streets. The National Conservative bloc, to which the army leadership belonged, was generally unconcerned if the SA assaulted communists, socialists, and Jews. But their rowdiness threatened to get out of hand and destabilize German commerce and local government. The SA leadership, stressing the social in National Socialism, was also calling for radically redistributive economic measures. This undermined Hitler's appeal to the conservative elites on whose support and expertise he extensively relied during the Nazis' early period in power. As far as the Reichswehr in particular was concerned, Röhm called for the SA to be absorbed into it. This would not only fully militarize the much larger SA, but also enable it virtually to swallow up the Reichswehr. Hitler was well aware of how much this prospect alarmed the Reichswehr leadership. And this was an elite whose professionalism Hitler badly needed if he were to realize his military and foreign policy goals. Many officers with socially conservative views commonplace in the West during the 1930s also deplored the open homosexuality of Röhm and other SA leaders. This concern, however, was secondary to the power political danger the SA posed. Relations between the two organizations were not entirely antagonistic. Many middle-ranking army officers enjoyed good working relations with senior SA men, who were mostly ex-soldiers themselves, over matters of training and border security. Overall, however, the Reichswehr leadership regarded the SA with palpable alarm, and as a menace, if not to its own existence, then certainly to its power position in matters of national defense. The key individual in Röhm's eventual downfall was Heinrich Himmler. Himmler commanded the Schutzstaffel, the SS. The SS had been founded in 1925, essentially as Hitler's personal bodyguard, or Leibstandarte. So loyal did it prove to Hitler that, on the Nazis' assumption of power, he expanded his bodyguard to regimental size as the Leibstandarte Adolf Hitler, or LAH. That same year, further SS units raised as guards for the new concentration camps were organized into Totenkopf, Death's Head units. Then, in 1934, three regiments of special service troops, the SS-Verfügungstruppe, or SSVT, were raised to suppress internal insurrections. Both they and the LAH were fitted out as motorized infantry. Eventually, they would form the nucleus of the mechanized divisions of the Waffen-SS, literally Weapons SS. In 1934, meanwhile, the SSVT would play a key role in removing Röhm and his colleagues. Himmler, though technically subordinate to Röhm, sought to discredit him in Hitler's eyes and advance his own ambitions by claiming that Röhm was plotting a coup against Hitler. Given that Hitler was anxious to retain the conservatives' support and aware of their antipathy towards the SA, Himmler was to some extent pushing at an open door. For his part, Blomberg told Hitler that if he did not restore order and bring the SA back under control, President Hindenburg would declare martial law. To give such demands more traction, Reichswehr intelligence uncovered an order from Röhm for arming the SA in preparation for an attack on the army. On the night of 30 June 1934, Röhm and other SA leaders were seized by the SS, then murdered either on the spot or over the following days. The purge, known as the Night of the Long Knives, also wiped out numerous other real or imagined opponents and critics of Hitler's leadership. Two former generals, Kurt von Schleicher, Hitler's predecessor as Chancellor, and his aide, Major General Ferdinand von Bredow, were among the slain. These particular killings appalled many army officers. For Captain Henning von Tresco, the affair strengthened his growing disgust at the Nazi regime, a disgust that had already been brewing with the regime's assault on the German constitution and its undermining of the churches. But other officers, satisfied that the SA had been neutralized, kept their disgust private. Reichenau exploited this sentiment in guidelines for the Reichswehr's political instruction, issued in 1934, which proclaimed, "The Reich Chancellor kept his word when he nipped in the bud Röhm's attempt to incorporate the SA into the Reichswehr. We love him because he has shown himself a true soldier." Blomberg now directed the army's troops to view SS men as comrades. At the same time, Himmler was using the power vacuum created by the Night of the Long Knives to buttress the power base of the SS, extend its control to the state's political forces, and build up the already existing SS formations as the nucleus of the future Waffen-SS, a body that would eventually rival the army for control of military manpower and resources. Blomberg, in his capacity as Minister for War, now authorized numerous measures that aided and abetted this process. Among other things, he gave his approval for the Totenkopf formations to become a division in the event of war. By contrast, the leadership of the army itself tried to delay the development of militarized SS units, restrict the expansion of their training, and retain overall control over them. It got its way, but only temporarily. In other respects, both Blomberg and the army leadership further rewarded the faith Hitler was placing in them. Following President Hindenburg's death in August 1934, Hitler merged the offices of Chancellor and State President into the new office of Führer. Blomberg and the Reichenau now devised an oath of loyalty for the troops to swear to Hitler personally. Though Fritsch and Beck had deep misgivings about subordinating the army to Hitler to this extent, the great majority of officers readily acquiesced in it. The oath exemplified how far the military leadership was increasingly prepared to identify itself with the Nazi regime as it sought to consolidate its own position in the new Reich. On the swearing of the oath, Colonel General Wilhelm Heyer, a former Reichswehr army head, proclaimed, "Adolf Hitler has given us the most soldierly state, a united German Wehrmacht, armed forces, without territorial boundaries and with the unified army, a unified Luftwaffe, and a unified navy." After 1945, many former officers would claim that the obligation under which the oath had placed them, and its appeal to their sense of soldierly honor, had prevented them from acting independently of or against the Nazi regime. "The oath of allegiance was not something we had learned to play fast and loose with," maintained Erich von Manstein. Yet there is a healthy cynicism in suspecting that at least some officers only discovered this moral dilemma after 1945 so as to justify their earlier inaction. The army leadership was also increasingly dazzled by the military possibilities now opening up. In the spring of 1935, the entire army underwent its single most radical transformation under the Third Reich. Hitler publicly declared he was ending the Versailles armaments restrictions, reintroducing conscription, and founding a new and expanded army, navy, and air force under the collective name of the Wehrmacht. Among other things, Hitler announced that he intended to build a peacetime force of 36 divisions, a fivefold increase in the army's size. The great majority of the new divisions would be infantry divisions. As the army continuously expanded and reorganized over the years before and throughout the war, its infantry divisions would be categorized in different waves. First wave divisions would comprise the army's active peacetime infantry divisions and would be the most formidable in terms of manpower and equipment. Divisions in successive waves were less generously furnished on both scores. Moreover, their manpower largely comprised different types of reservists of varying degrees of quality. From the start, however, the most important and formidable element of all in the army's evolution would be its armored force. Not only the army's composition was transformed, but also its character. A peacetime expansion to 36 divisions, even without the army's likely wartime manpower needs, meant that neither the new army nor its officer corps could remain the socially selective, technocratic institution of the Weimar years. This, Hitler declared, was to be a true people's army, representing all sectors of German society. A particularly pressing challenge was finding enough suitable officer material. A flood of young recruits and older reactivated officers now entered the Corps. Moreover, during 1935 and 1936, 56,000 policemen joined the Wehrmacht, 1,200 of them as officers. This measure increasingly blurred the distinction between Army and SS, as the latter achieved full control of Germany's police forces between 1934 and 1936. Himmler's control over the German police force was formalized in June 1936. Hitler augmented his title as head of the SS to appoint him Reichsführer SS und Chef der Deutschen Polizei. From then on, the SS and police was officially one organization. The army also endeavored to recruit officers from among higher-level school students, capitalizing on Nazi ideology's saturation of the school curriculum. In the later words of Major General Hans Friesner, the Army's Inspector of Education and Training, the Wehrmacht has not just the right, but also the duty to align all educational and training methods with its demands, and thereby secure the best degree of military power. Nevertheless, the Army's recruitment efforts in schools were initially ad hoc. Their most pressing concern was simply to pack as many new recruits into the officer corps as possible. Despite all these measures, the army remained under-officered when it went to war, a deficiency that would worsen as the war continued. The vast new intake transformed the officer corps' social makeup. Between 1928 and 1930, nearly two-thirds of officer candidates still originated from the officer corps' favored aristocratic and upper-middle-class circles. The new officer corps did not entirely embody the People's Army of Nazi rhetoric. Between 1939 and 1941, men from aristocratic and upper-middle-class backgrounds comprised a quarter of all candidates. As a proportion of the population, then, they were still overrepresented. But the officer corps certainly reflected the entire swath of the German middle and upper classes more than before. In particular, the 1939 to 1941 period saw men from extensively pro-Nazi white-collar families rise from a third to 54% of all candidates. Though the working class was largely absent, rapidly mounting wartime casualties would eventually change that. But by the late 1930s, any distinctive, long-established officer ethos was already disappearing. Instead, the Wehrmacht and army leadership sought to ingrain officers and men with a new mentality befitting an army that supposedly embodied the new community to which all politically and racially acceptable Germans were deemed to belong. During 1935 and 1936, the Wehrmacht produced numerous publications intended to inculcate officers and men with the importance of the military and political tasks that faced them. It was Blomberg, again, who played the largest role. In July 1936, he ordered that any politically unreliable officer be reported to the Gestapo. He assisted the Nazi attack on organized religion by making church services for the troops optional instead of compulsory. Jews were to be excluded from the officer corps and the army, and Blomberg also banned soldiers from marrying non-Aryan women or patronizing Jewish warehouses and shops. But Blomberg's perhaps most far-reaching measure came on 30 January 1936, the third anniversary of the Nazis' accession to power, when he ordered officer colleges and academies to devote at least 2 hours per month to national political teaching. Officers down to company level were to take direct responsibility for such teaching, and also to convey to their men the importance of the unity and community of soldiery and National Socialist ideology. Yet only in the final years of the war would the Wehrmacht seek to instill a spirit of true ideological fanaticism into its troops. In 1935, by contrast, Hitler declared himself not concerned that the recruits coming in turn the soldiers into National Socialists, but that the army turn the National Socialists coming into it into soldiers. Therein, however, lay the rub. For many of the ordinary Germans who were coming into the army had reason to feel less than effusive about the Nazi regime. It is always difficult to find reliable measures of public opinion under a dictatorship. Nevertheless, the morale reports of the Reich Security Service, Sicherheitsdienst, or SD, as well as from the Social Democratic Party of Germany, Sozialdemokratische Partei Deutschlands, or SPD, and other non-Nazi organizations in exile, together helped to build a semi-reliable picture. Although unemployment largely disappeared under the Nazis, Germans in the main did not feel a surge in personal prosperity, because the German economy's overwhelming focus on rearmament limited families' access not just to consumer goods, but also to foodstuffs and essentials. Many lower middle-class Germans were disgruntled when the Nazis reneged on their pre-1933 promise to break up large department stores in favor of small businesses, and rural Germans were aggrieved when the regime similarly abandoned a pledge to redistribute agricultural land. Many workers resented, at least initially, the destruction of the trade unions and the suppression of wage increases. Religiously minded Germans, particularly Catholics, railed at Nazi attacks on freedom of worship. And Germans across the social spectrum widely despised the arrogance, incompetence, and corruption of local Nazi party officials. Quite apart from anything else, from German unification through the Imperial and Weimar eras, Germans had continued to feel a strong sense of local and regional identity, of Heimat. How a local or regional community's social and religious composition broke down then was something that might make it more receptive to Nazism, or, by the same token, less receptive. Either way, there was a limit to how far the Nazis were able to beget a true uniform spirit of Volksgemeinschaft among the German people. There was, therefore, also a limit to how Nazified the army's new recruits were likely to be. Even so, it would be nonsense to conclude that 1930s Nazi Germany was essentially a nation of unenthused grumblers. The disturbing truth is that Nazism integrated Germans much more than it alienated them. This, in turn, assured the army a flood of recruits who, though they might not be fanatical hardcore Nazis in the main, were well disposed towards the worldview the Nazis propagated and ready to take up arms in its cause. Pernicious anti-Semitism was widespread in the West during the interwar years, but in Germany, partly because of developments during and immediately after the First World War, it was more pronounced than in numerous other countries. Mainstream Germans may not have felt as intensely anti-Semitic as the Nazis, but the Nazis did persuade more than enough Germans during the 1930s that there was indeed a Jewish problem, even if most Germans preferred to see it solved by legislative discrimination rather than brutal terror. Many officers who had hitherto served with the police held authoritarian attitudes strongly in tune with Nazi values. More generally, Nazi policies provided plenty for which the bulk of mainstream Germans were grateful. The ordered state of German society following the chaos of the late Weimar years and the restoration of full employment were successes that the Nazis trumpeted to the utmost via their propaganda machine. Even though the Nazis could not rightly claim full credit for this state of affairs, and full employment was not accompanied by significant wage rises, most ordinary Germans felt personally and economically safer under the Nazis than under Weimar. Mass propaganda media, the education system, youth groups, and services in the RAD all combined to instill a feel-good attitude based upon this sense of security, together with messages of national pride, unity, and purpose. Furthermore, discriminating against Jews and against social and political undesirables made mainstream Germans feel more integrated. Those Germans who met the right social, political, and, above all, racial criteria could feel part of a national community and enjoy far greater self-confidence than they had a few years previously. In the words of Sönke Neitzel and Harald Welzer, "It is no accident that Germans of that generation tend to describe the Third Reich, up until Germany's military defeat at Stalingrad, as a great time." Such people were categorically incapable of experiencing the exclusion, persecution, and dispossession of others for what they were. This attitude did not condition people to wish genocide on the Jews or any other group, but it did help to numb ordinary Germans during the 1930s to the discrimination and persecution inflicted upon out-groups. These groups comprised Jews most prominently, but also religious and political dissidents and an array of supposed social deviants, including juvenile delinquents, homosexuals, prostitutes, alcoholics, travelers, the homeless, and the work shy. Among Germans who went on to serve in the Wehrmacht, it would not be too much of a leap to argue that being harshly disposed towards such groups and numb to their suffering might beget a similar attitude towards civilians in at least some parts of occupied Europe during the war itself. There is also every reason to suppose that German youth tended to be more receptive than older age groups to National Socialist messages. This, of course, would have a direct effect upon the main influx of recruits into the army. Depending on their particular age, most of the army's young new recruits during the Third Reich would already have undergone ideological and militaristic programming in schools, the Hitler Youth Movement, and the RAD. The Hitler Youth, which comprised the Deutsche Jungvolk for boys aged between 10 and 14, and then the Hitler Jugend, the Hitler Youth proper, for those aged up to 18, also provided boys with activities such as hiking, camping, and orienteering. Such activities, as well as being enjoyable in their own right, enabled German boys to become physically fit and acquire a range of practical skills applicable to soldiering. Just as importantly, the Hitler Youth sought to infuse its members with a strong sense of comradeship. As one former Hitler Youth leader recalled after the war, "I was full of enthusiasm when I joined the Jungvolk at the age of 10. What boy isn't fired by being presented with high ideals such as comradeship, loyalty, and honor?" In June 1934, an informer for the SPD in exile described the attitude of German youth. "The drill, the uniform, the camp life, the fact that school and the parental home take second place behind the community of the young, all this is wonderful. Great times without danger. Many believe that economic paths have opened to them due to the persecution of Jews and Marxists." The RAD was designed to toughen and socialize boys further, weed out any lingering bookish tendencies within them, and set them to providing a practical service for the Reich by working on motorway construction and other public works schemes. The RAD made heavy physical demands on its members. Friedrich Gruppe recalled, "Early in the morning at 4 a.m. out of bed to a long cross-country run with early morning exercise, then washing up, breakfast, ceremonial raising of the flag, and already by 5 a.m. marching to the labor site in work overalls with spades at our shoulders." The RAD also aimed to strengthen character, comradeship, and cohesion further, and indeed to replicate the Volksgemeinschaft in microcosm. Gruppe wrote in his diary in 1937, "We're putting our conception of National Socialism into action. We are all the same in our service for the people. No one has asked his origins or class, whether he is rich or poor." There were also specialist organizations to which many German youths belonged, such as the National Socialist Motor Vehicle Corps, Nationalsozialistische Kraftfahrkorps, or NSKK, which prepared them for future service in particular branches of the Wehrmacht. Further, the very fact that the Wehrmacht existed buttressed the Nazi regime's popularity among the general public, and consequently among the army's new recruits. When Hitler announced conscription, SPD informants noted the widespread enthusiasm this prompted, particularly among the young. Conscription appealed to the militaristic attitudes that much of the public had harbored during as well as before the Weimar years. It also appealed to the view that it does the young fellows no harm if once again they get knocked into shape, as SPD informants in Bavaria put it. It was also another sign that Germany had returned to the ranks of the great powers. From 1934 onwards, the Nazi Party's annual Nuremberg rally included a Day of the Wehrmacht, featuring enormous parades and displays of military equipment. Skilled workers felt considerable pride over the armaments they were producing. This was also a further means of cementing the bond between troops and people. As a wartime Panzer manual asserted, "For every shell you fire, your father has paid 100 Reichsmarks in taxes, your mother has worked for a week in the factory." Nazi propaganda minister Josef Goebbels further promoted the Wehrmacht's image with a sustained campaign of positive press coverage. At the heart of all this was the figure of Hitler himself. Nazi propaganda ascribed to him almost superhuman powers and created a potent Hitler myth in the process. It successfully credited him with all the regime's purported social and economic achievements and promoted a personal image that enabled him to avoid blame for all the defects of the regime that the German public identified. The deeply integrating effect Hitler would come to have upon many ordinary Germans would reach its zenith in the wake of Germany's lightning victory over France in 1940, but the groundwork was laid during the early to mid-1930s. Regardless of which branch of the army soldiers were eventually selected for, their raising and training was the task in the first instance of the replacement army, Ersatzheer. The basic operational unit of the army was the division. This was the lowest level of formation that was capable of independent operational level combat activity, encompassing as it did combat troops, communications troops, and support services. Each of the new army's divisions contained a replacement battalion that directly undertook the training of new recruits. These were then transferred to a march battalion, which was responsible in turn for transferring them to their parent division. Upon arrival at their parent division, the men of the march battalion were distributed across the various regiments. This was also a regionally based system. Reich territory was organized into military districts, Wehrkreise. Divisions were raised within particular Wehrkreise, and their troops could thus expect to go on to serve alongside comrades from the same region as themselves. The system was also designed to ensure that, come wartime, soldiers who were wounded were returned to their old units once they had convalesced. Indeed, each division had its own convalescent home. Because this system was regionally based, it made army units considerably more cohesive. The new army retained the Reichswehr's intensive approach to training. Recruits first completed 16 weeks of basic training under the replacement battalion. Physical standards were exacting, army training particularly priding itself on getting troops to march long distances with full kit. Some training depots took things to extremes. There was nothing unique about a training program that sought to dehumanize recruits in order to fashion a cohesive force out of them, but some depots subjected their recruits to particular humiliation. According to veterans interviewed after 1945, recruits were sometimes ordered to clean latrines with a toothbrush, or, apparently an established tradition in the German army, pluck straw out of excrement. There was no recourse to official complaint. Yet soldiers who endured all this seem mainly to have regarded it as hard drill necessary for promoting soldierly discipline. Trainee officers experienced high training standards also. Until 1937, they underwent a 4-year training program. This was then shortened, but its requirements remained strict. The army also sought to avoid recruiting substandard officer material, relying instead upon correspondingly greater numbers of NCOs. Under the Reichswehr, NCOs had undergone 3.5 years of training. This had created a firm base of high-quality NCOs upon which the new army could now build. The new army itself had to accelerate the NCO production line, and it did so in 2 ways. At the age of 16, Hitler Youth boys spent 2 weeks in barracks on a military preparation camp, where they received lessons in marksmanship with rifles and machine guns. Those who performed most outstandingly could then attend preliminary NCO training. After a year of this, they received another 6 months' training as Obergrenadiere. Alternatively, NCOs could be selected after showing sufficient promise in their first year as a private soldier. In order to attract more recruits to the NCO pool, potential trainees were offered a 5-year service option alongside the already established 12-year option. These truncated procedures did not reduce the quality of NCOs, for the army also retained the Reichswehr's emphasis on developing aggressive, flexible, and independent thinking in both officers and NCOs, the better to acclimatize them to the demands of Auftragstaktik. In the words of a training directive of October 1940, "Bravery and personal ability are not enough. The younger NCOs who have been proven in war are to be made aware of how they can become leaders, educators, and instructors." The new Truppenführung, Troop Leadership Manual of 1933, had such principles at its heart, stating that unpredictable factors often have decisive influence, and stressing that the commander must act as leader and educator in all situations. How all this translated into practice and the thoroughness of the training that the troops received are exemplified by infantry training. German army training principles during the 1930s maintained that the most important infantry weapon was the machine gun. Until 1942, the German infantry's main machine gun was the MG-34. This weapon was effective on both the offensive and the defensive, and could also bring down aircraft. It had a higher rate of fire than its British equivalent, the Bren. The German army believed that the machine gun, with support from riflemen, was the key to winning firefights. Hence, a machine gun, and with it the equivalent firepower of a whole platoon of riflemen, was allotted to every German infantry section. The army's infantry squad tactics, as laid out in the Truppenführung manual, built on older principles of German military training. They stressed flexible and independent-minded thinking, aggression, physical resourcefulness, and the effective use of weaponry. In deploying his squad for combat, the squad leader needed to take rapid note of the surrounding terrain and position his men to exploit fully the available contours and cover. Trees, for instance, made ideal positions for riflemen. The squad leader was also expected rapidly to select the best targets. Infantry training enabled squad leaders to improve this skill by simultaneously presenting flags indicating different potential targets in different locations. By these means, the squad leader and his men gained experience in identifying the most threatening targets. Recruits also practiced full-blown fire and maneuver against serious resistance. Among other things, they were trained to throw grenades while on the move. No detail was neglected. For instance, recruits were also trained to move their bodies tactically, by such means as crawling undercover, going on all fours, or worming on their stomachs and pushing with their feet. So superior were the new army's resources to those of the old Reichswehr that the Truppenführung manual was also able to resurrect the principles of well-provisioned defense in depth. Such techniques had greatly aided the Germans on the Western Front during the First World War. Outposts would be positioned before the forward defense line in order to delay and disrupt the enemy advance. The forward line itself would be the forefront of an in-depth trench system containing obstacles, small dugouts, and nests of individual arms. The troops would make rapid local counterattacks, preferably in the enemy's flanks. Where necessary, they would delay the enemy with resistance, including artillery bombardment, to buy time and cover withdrawal to rear defensive lines. In sum, the troops would employ changing behavior, mobility, speed, surprise, concealment, and other methods of deception, all examples of improvisation emanating from Auftragstaktik. Formidable as this corpus of training and doctrine was, the German infantry of the 1930s did not become a smooth-running machine overnight. For instance, as the Army's 1936 maneuvers showed, troops often failed to distinguish between a fighting withdrawal and an actual retreat. Even so, the quality of the training they were receiving was clear. Two things above all set the German army apart from those opponents it would face during the war's first 2 years: its emphasis on the qualities of Auftragstaktik and its ability consistently to refine and improve its training and doctrine. German armored warfare techniques were founded on the Army's experience of the stormtroop tactics of the First World War, of the Allies' combined arms offensives of 1918, and of the period of clandestine cooperation between the Reichswehr and the Red Army. The first Panzer Troop School was founded in November 1933. Basic training was the same as the infantry's, together with additional training in anti-tank gunnery. After 6 months, recruits were split into groups for further training as gunners, panzer drivers and mechanics, or signalmen. Exposing panzer recruits to infantry and anti-tank training was one of the ways in which they became proficient in combined arms fighting. Gunnery practice involved various techniques, including firing at moving targets dragged by sledges. Teamwork was even more central for panzers than for infantry. Tank men were trained individually at first, but then the various members of a particular panzer's crew were brought together to operate as a team. Commanders of individual panzers were drawn from the best trained crews, panzer platoon commanders from the best individual panzer commanders. The new army's first major development in armored warfare came with the formation of the first four panzer divisions in 1935. Panzer divisions were designed as self-supporting mini-armies based solidly on combined arms principles. They comprised not only panzers, but also motorized infantry, artillery, pioneers, reconnaissance, and a motorized supply column. They were thus well-suited to operating independently and to optimizing those key qualities of initiative, flexibility, and aggression that were at the core of German army doctrine. Once the panzers had broken through the enemy's defense line, motorized infantry and artillery would move up rapidly to form a hole that could withstand enemy counterattack. This force would then regroup, advance, and repeat the process. Over the course of the war, the advantages of the Panzer Division's organization were applied to ever larger groupings, Panzer Corps, Panzer Groups, and eventually Panzer Armies, and to smaller special-purpose Kampfgruppen, battle groups. Replicating the Panzer Division's strength on such a scale increasingly enabled Panzer formations not just to break through the enemy's lines, but also to fan out and link up with one another far into the enemy's rear, then encircle and destroy his forces. The new Luftwaffe would be allotted an important supporting role, disrupting the enemy's communications and efforts to get reinforcements up to the line. The new army further refined its armored warfare techniques by continuing the series of large-scale maneuvers that the Reichswehr had begun, only now using the real thing. According to his self-promoting memoirs, Heinz Guderian was not only one of Germany's leading armored warfare generals during the Second World War, but also the key figure in the development of the Panzer divisions during the 1930s. Guderian did indeed write several articles for specialist military journals, one of which was used by the general staff itself, and a book on armored warfare tactics, Achtung Panzer, which was widely read following its publication in 1937. But Guderian was also a brazen self-publicist whose overall contribution to the development of armored warfare, while undoubtedly important, was less epoch-making than he later claimed. In truth, Guderian was only one of several figures who contributed to the development of armored warfare within the German army, and the contributions made by some of these figures were more important than Guderian's. For instance, Colonel Oswald Lutz had assembled the Reichswehr's first makeshift combined arms mechanized force in 1930, a body that had gone on to form the basis of the Reichswehr's Motor Transport Command. He also commanded the 1st Panzer Division to undergo field maneuvers in August 1935. Lutz, now Lieutenant General, was first to recognize that panzers should operate as an aggressive, flexible, independent strike arm. He also believed they should attack the enemy in the flanks and at other weak spots identified at reconnaissance rather than head-on. And though Guderian and Lutz worked together to develop the panzer force, Lutz was senior and a more effective networker than his temperamental subordinate. Nor was Guderian the only German armored warfare theorist who proposed equipping panzers with radio. Guderian also exaggerated the degree of opposition that thrusting, dynamic panzer men, above all himself, faced from stuffy reactionaries at the army's head and within its other branches. The principal Luddite, according to Guderian, was General Beck, who supposedly said to him in 1934, "No, no, I don't want to have anything to do with you people. You move too fast for me." In fact, Beck was no stranger to innovation himself. After all, it was on his watch as Army Chief of Staff that the Truppenführung regulations were issued and the 1st Panzer Divisions established. As for his supposed disdain for armored warfare, in the autumn of 1935, he urged the creation of 48 new panzer battalions. Beck was concerned less about the value of an armored force per se than about its quality if it was expanded too rapidly. He and others also feared that expanding the armored force at breakneck speed would unbalance the entire army and prevent it from integrating that force effectively along sound combined arms principles. There was certainly major disagreement concerning the relationship panzers should have with infantry. In particular, the Truppenführung manual placed high priority on locating and enveloping the enemy's main force, but it saw the panzers' main role as supporting infantry attacks rather than operating as an independent strike force. Indeed, when it came to infantry armor cooperation, German tactics would still be found wanting come the outbreak of war. The mainstays of the early panzer divisions were their Mark I and Mark II light tanks. These were a far cry from the armored colossi of the Second World War's latter years. The particularly diminutive Mark I was equipped with two machine guns and armor only 30 millimeters, half an inch, thick. But the Mark II was a clear improvement. Even though its greater weight hindered cross-country movement, it was faster than the Mark I and also sported a 2-centimeter gun and armor of up to 30 millimeters thick. As the 1930s went on, medium Mark III and IV Panzers came into production. These were developed as a compromise between Guderian's preference for a large force of light tanks and the need for heavy models. A major advantage was their ability to upgrade their armor and armament. They would not be mass-produced, however, until the war itself. Production of the Panzer Force and the phases of its technical development from the Mark I's and II's in 1935 through to the colossal Tiger II nearly a decade later were the work of different companies at different times, including Krupp, Henschel, Porsche, and Daimler-Benz. Heading army planning was the new General Staff. Modelled on the old Imperial General Staff, it similarly underwent a rigorous, extensive training program. Yet the program reflected the weaknesses as well as strengths of German military thinking. Staff officers were immersed in all manner of operational planning, but their schooling in broader matters such as strategy, diplomacy, and logistics was still less thorough than it needed to be. Moreover, officers received only a handful of lectures on military intelligence and no detailed training in intelligence techniques. The army was also having to fight a turf war with the new Wehrmachtsamt, Wehrmacht Office, the renamed Reichswehr Ministry with General von Blomberg at its head. General von Fritsch and General Beck wanted the army to retain a dominant, independent policy role, but Blomberg wanted it brought more firmly under the aegis of the Wehrmachtsamt. Blomberg received ample assistance from numerous army officers such as Wilhelm Keitel and Alfred Jodl, who had been appointed to work in the Wehrmachtsamt. Once they became ministry men, they went native, undermining efforts to maintain a separate and powerful army command and seeking to subordinate elements of the armed forces to Hitler more directly. The army leadership became mired in this dispute at a time when Reich Marshal Hermann Göring and Grand Admiral Erich Raeder, commanders-in-chief of the Luftwaffe and Kriegsmarine, respectively, were able to gain ever more unfettered access to Hitler. Far from being a parochial dispute, turf wars between the army and central Wehrmacht offices would increasingly debilitate the unity and effectiveness of the high command structure. Between 1933 and 1936, then, the German army leadership took its first largely willing steps down a path of growing subordination to the Nazi regime. It did so largely for political and professional reasons. Regardless of how far many generals shared the Nazis' repugnance of Jews and Bolsheviks, they supported the new regime primarily because of what it offered the army: conscription, rearmament, technological investment, and the mobilization of society. Different parts of this package spoke to different generals in different ways. Guderian's technocratic sensitivities, for instance, were particularly enticed by the third of these. And no one surpassed Blomberg in his enthusiasm for Nazism's apparent potential to mobilize and unify society, as his own courting of the SS showed. But the entire package spoke to the general's vision of an aggrandized army, with the full economic and political backing of the state, restoring Germany's great power status through war. The potency of this vision outweighed the disapproval with which some generals regarded Nazism's rowdier, more radical elements, or the lower middle-class background of the movement's leaders. It also helped to blind generals to the frightening scale of Hitler's own ambitions. The generals' complicity in political murder was the first step in their wider collusion in the regime's crimes. They were also instrumental in indoctrinating the army's vastly augmented manpower from 1935 onwards. This new army was as socially diverse as it was vast. Nevertheless, its new personnel were largely willing to adhere to the ideological nationalistic agenda the army served. The regime's social and economic policies, its propagandizing and mobilization of German youth, and the appeal of the Volksgemeinschaft and of Hitler himself all fused with the militaristic attitudes that permeated much of German society. The army's Panzer wing developed, and the army as a whole inherited the superior doctrine and training methods that the Reichswehr had bequeathed. Nevertheless, breakneck expansion brought growing pains, and institutional turf wars and poor strategic grasp limited the effectiveness of the army's highest command levels. All these trends would become more pronounced as war approached during the late 1930s. Chapter 2: The Road to War, 1936 to 1939. The more enemies, the more honor. This was General von Blomberg's riposte to worries that Germany's rapid rearmament would antagonize foreign nations. It was a particularly guileless statement, even by his standards. Between 1936 and 1939, the massive rearmament drive ordered by Hitler and lauded by the Wehrmacht had equally massive destabilizing effects upon Germany's economy, the international diplomatic system, and the international military balance. The result was a major war of a kind that Germany had not expected to fight so soon, and for which it was not fully prepared. Many senior officers were concerned at the pace of events, but some were more concerned than others, and none took effective united action to slow or halt it. But this is unsurprising, given the alacrity with which the army became further subjugated to the Nazi regime during this time. The pressures spawned by rearmament cast an ever darker shadow over the whole period, and it is worth briefly surveying those pressures before examining the German army's role in the path to war more closely. From 1935, rearmament soaked up the great majority of the Nazi regime's re-employment efforts, and this made increasing demands upon the German economy. In 1932, 8 million citizens of Weimar Germany were unemployed. Between then and 1934, the last Weimar governments and then the Nazis themselves sought to boost employment through public works schemes. Most of these were non-military in nature. Rearmament itself was slow to commence because the infrastructure of rearmament, including bases and barracks, had to be created first. But from 1935, rearmament and schemes to build public works with a military use, such as the new Autobahnen, were Hitler's favored means of continuing to drive down unemployment, favored, of course, because they corresponded to his warlike ambitions. In focusing so predominantly on preparation for war, the German economy faced two particular problems. Firstly, it was heavily dependent upon international resources. Secondly, it was faced with trying to reconcile the rearmament drive with German civilians' need for foodstuffs and consumer goods. This guns versus butter problem heavily preoccupied the regime during the 1930s. The satirical British magazine Punch lampooned the Nazis' dilemma in June 1937. It published a cartoon of Hitler training a Dachshund dressed as a soldier to resist food. The dog balances a lump of fat on his nose while balancing his own body on a munition shell. Trust is the cartoon's title. Yes, but I've been trusting such a long time, retorts the dog. These twin dangers threatened to suck in imports to an extent that could precipitate a balance of payments crisis, sparking runaway inflation and potentially destroying public support for the regime. In order to sustain such a massive rearmament drive, then, the Nazi regime needed a resource base large enough to enable it to satisfy the needs of both rearmament and the civilian population. Ultimately, it would find that it could only secure such a resource base by embarking upon foreign conquests even sooner. Yet the economic dilemma it faced was still not enough on its own to compel Germany into war as early as 1939. For the regime was able to employ various measures to ease its predicament, or at least stave off the point at which it might grow critical. At no time between 1933 and 1939 did the German people suffer economic hardships anything like as bad as those they had endured between 1929 and 1932. Agricultural reforms and selective rationing sustained Germany's food supply, and welfare payments further dampened the potential for unrest. The Nazis introduced wage and price controls to manage inflation, and the apparatus of state terror suppressed remaining discord. The quarter from which the Nazis might have expected the most social trouble was the industrialized working class. Yet strict work regulations, the destruction of the trade unions, the efficacy of the Kraft durch Freude, strength through joy organization, or KDF, and Nazi propaganda's appeal to anti-Semitism and working-class patriotism all helped to stifle potential working-class dissent. In October 1936, moreover, Hitler introduced the four-year plan, a drive for economic self-sufficiency designed to make Germany less reliant upon imports. Yet though all these measures might go some way to counteracting the mounting pressures upon the German economy, there was a limit to what they could do in the long term. for the pressures themselves intensified as a result of the international arms race precipitated by the rearmament and expansion not only of Nazi Germany, but also of fascist Italy and Imperial Japan. Both countries were not only governed, like Germany, by aggressive militaristic regimes. In the wake of the economic crisis of the early 1930s, they believed that conquering foreign territory and resources would make them economically self-sufficient and immune to the ill winds of the global economy. As a result, all of Germany's major potential opponents in a future war, Great Britain, France, the Soviet Union, and the United States, began to raise military spending as the 1930s went on. As far as Hitler was concerned, Germany could not risk losing ground in the arms race it had helped precipitate, and the pressure to keep pace intensified the very same economic and political problems that the Nazi regime was seeking to ease. As a result, Hitler injected an ever greater element of risk into his foreign policy. He accelerated its timetable to seize more territory and resources, further escalating international tensions in the process. This made a general European war likely sooner rather than later, when neither the Reich nor the German army was fully prepared for it. In March 1936, Germany's stock of foreign raw materials and grain dwindled to perilously low levels. That same month, Hitler took radical action to try to ease the economic pressure. His focus was on the region of Germany west of the River Rhine. The Rhineland had been demilitarized under the terms of the Treaty of Versailles, with Germany forbidden to call up recruits or keep troops there and restricted as to what types of weaponry it could produce there. Ending these restrictions by fully reincorporating the Rhineland into Germany had always been a long-term aim of Hitler's, as indeed it would have been for any interwar German government, since it would help secure Germany's western frontier in the event of war. Hitler's decision to remilitarize the Rhineland quickly was prompted by the growing pressures on the economy, and, if the SD's regular morale reports are to be believed, by the effect that stagnating living standards were having upon public opinion. Not only would remilitarizing the Rhineland provide a foreign policy boost to the regime's popularity, it would also free up the Rhineland's industrial capacity for arms production. Hitler also moved when he did because of the opportunities the international situation presented. Hitler and the army leadership were aware, as Britain and France would have been aware had they intervened, that the German army was still far from ready for war. But Hitler gambled, if not all that recklessly, that the British and French governments would be too distracted by other problems, both domestic and international, to intervene. Above all, Hitler knew that the British and French were currently preoccupied with fascist Italy's recent invasion of Abyssinia in East Africa. With the United States pursuing a policy of international isolation, Britain and France were the leading lights in the League of Nations, the worthy but toothless arbiter of international disputes that had been founded after the First World War. The League's condemnation of the invasion had turned Italy away from Britain and France, thus making her unlikely to support either of them in a stand against Germany. Hitler's judgment proved correct. When German troops marched in, their apparent numbers swelled by clever editing of the Nazi propaganda newsreels, Britain and France did indeed stop short of intervention. Hitler's success in reoccupying the Rhineland buttressed the Nazi regime's domestic popularity, and the passive British and French response emboldened him further. Among other things, he now became less inclined to heed any general who might counsel caution over Germany's lack of military preparedness against Britain and France. He noted Fritsch and Beck's opposition to the Rhineland operation. Among other things, they had scorned the idea of disguising the troops' movements as SA and RAD exercises. He also noted the distinct lack of nerve Blomberg had displayed during the operation's more tense moments, later accusing the Wehrmacht commander-in-chief of behaving like a hysterical old maid. But Britain and France's inaction over the Rhineland brought no let-up in their own rearmament efforts. In August 1936, for instance, the government in Paris approved a 14 billion franc program to expand the French army. The Wehrmacht reacted by making further demands on the German economy. In June 1936, for instance, the army called for enough infrastructure and equipment to support a field army of over 100 divisions and 3.5 million men by the autumn of 1940. It also called for the establishment of three new 500-strong panzer divisions, in addition to the three founded in October 1935, and four motorized divisions and three light divisions of more than 200 armored fighting vehicles apiece. Fulfilling demands for weaponry of such a patently offensive nature could only alarm foreign governments further and provoke them into rearming even faster. Moreover, producing all this war material would mean retooling many German factories and also building many new ones. Furthermore, once such factories were geared towards producing armaments, they would need to keep receiving huge follow-on orders in order to maintain war readiness. The only alternative would be to convert them to civilian production, but that risked creating huge unemployment and delaying their reconversion once war actually broke out. Thus did Germany's rearmament drive generate a further self-reinforcing momentum. In October 1936, as the arms race and its challenges intensified further, Hitler appointed Hermann Göring as head of the Office of the Four-Year Plan. The latter's purpose was to make Germany less reliant on foreign exchange and more economically self-sufficient. Above all, Hitler declared that the Wehrmacht must be operational within 4 years and the German economy fit for war within the same time frame. The four-year plan made a particular push for companies to develop synthetic materials. Many other materials were rationed. When the private sector could not provide the necessary industrial capacity, the regime established its own companies to do the job. Overall, however, the plan's successes were patchy, the rearmament push stagnated, and shortages grew increasingly acute. In October 1936, for instance, the army had estimated it needed 270,500 tons of steel per month, but from the following February it received only 195,000 per month. The army was also in intense competition for resources with the Luftwaffe and the Kriegsmarine. The Wirtschaftsrüstungsamt, Wehrmacht Office of Economics and Armaments, headed by Colonel Georg Thomas, did draw up guidelines for more orderly allocation, but the three services flouted them. Indeed, in July 1937, Thomas complained to Hitler, "The battle for steel is even being fought with underhanded means. This disorder undermines the smooth running of the economy and endangers the authority of the state." Hitler, whether in order to divide and rule, or because he lacked the grasp or inclination to assert himself in economic policy as in foreign policy, failed to impose any effective system from above. Göring, too much the economic dilettante despite his undoubted radical drive, failed likewise. At least army doctrine did not stagnate, particularly when it came to armored warfare. The September 1936 maneuvers in Hesse explored how panzers should be used, particularly in terrain such as the muddy plains of Poland and the Western Soviet Union. The autumn 1937 maneuvers in Mecklenburg had a particularly marked effect upon armored doctrine. They were conducted in arduous terrain in which the panzers had to negotiate rolling hills and high water rivers and lakes without the support of an adequate transport infrastructure. The outcome of the maneuvers was effectively decided within around less than half of the 7 days allocated to them, when the 3rd Panzer Division played the leading role in capturing the bridgehead at Malchin. This proved that panzers could play a spearheading role in combined arms tactics and not just act as support for infantry. The Mecklenburg maneuvers were, in Robert Citino's words, the panzers' coming out party. The panzers also benefited from real combat experience, for German panzer and air crews grouped under the Condor Legion fought on the nationalist side during the Spanish Civil War of 1936 to 1939. The panzer formations became familiar with ground combat, while the Luftwaffe carried out interdiction missions, disrupting the enemy's supply, communications, and troop movements, not to mention obliterating the defenseless town of Guernica as target practice for strategic bombing. In November 1937, Hitler grew even more vocal in his fears for Germany's performance in the arms race and for its long-term future. On 5 November, he held a meeting of his military chiefs at the Reich Chancellery in Berlin. Hitler's army adjutant, Colonel Friedrich Hosbach, took handwritten notes. Hitler asserted that Germany lacked the means of long-term economic self-sufficiency. that reclaiming Germany's lost colonies in Africa was not a viable alternative, and that, above all, Germany needed to conquer foreign territory for Lebensraum in the East. This third point was not new to Hitler's audience. What was new was the timetable Hitler now announced for achieving it. He believed Germany would need to conquer for Lebensraum and thus precipitate war with the major European powers by 1943 to 1945 at the latest. After that, Germany's likely principal opponents would be too strong to defeat, and Germany itself would be blighted by food crises and falling birth rates. Obsessed with his own mortality, Hitler also cited the aging of the Nazi movement's leaders as a further reason to move sooner rather than later. Some of those present were particularly unsettled when Hitler outlined certain scenarios that, he asserted, should precipitate an early move against Austria and Czechoslovakia, despite the risk of war with Britain and France as a result. Securing Austria and Czechoslovakia would protect Germany's eastern flank prior to any attack she might launch in the west, as well as improve the security of Germany's frontiers more generally. Moreover, taking Austria and Czechoslovakia would win for the Reich not just an increased food supply, but also an influx of ethnic Germans to the tune of a further 12 army divisions. Blomberg, Fritsch, and indeed Göring, though not Kriegsmarine chief Raeder, who was itching to take on the Royal Navy, had misgivings. They were not concerned about the scale or direction Hitler was thinking of, but they were concerned about the timing. They particularly fretted that Hitler foresaw scenarios in which he would be willing to risk war with Britain and France before 1943, a combination that the three men were not convinced Germany was ready to face. Nevertheless, they all swung behind the plans in the meeting's aftermath. General Beck, however, was much more alarmed. He was increasingly fearful of the scale, direction, and timing of Hitler's territorial ambitions. For Beck, Austria and Czechoslovakia were living space, whereas Hitler merely saw them as a stepping stone to vast areas of Lebensraum further east. Beck did not oppose Hitler's foreign policy on moral grounds. Rather, he increasingly believed it would lead Germany into a major war too soon, with catastrophic results. He also continued to believe that Germany's interests lay not in a race war in Eastern Europe, but in regional hegemony over Central Europe. In 1938, however, Blomberg, Fritsch, and Beck would all depart their posts. In their place would come a new military command structure, led for the most part by men more unquestioning of Hitler's will. In January 1938, both Blomberg and Fritsch were brought low by personal scandals of a kind that touched both the social and ideological nerves of the time. Blomberg's new wife was revealed as a former prostitute. Blomberg's married a whore, as Göring announced it. In an added twist, it transpired that she had had a Jewish pimp at one point. Perhaps above all, Hitler feared for his own prestige. Having been a witness at the wedding, he now faced the danger of being a laughingstock if he did not take decisive action. Blomberg might just have held on in the face of all this, but his particular subservience to Hitler and the Nazis, especially his efforts to impose centralized control on all three branches of the Wehrmacht, had deprived him of influential friends among the army leadership. These included General von Fritsch. Ironically, Fritsch himself ended up having to resign almost simultaneously. His opposition to the military expansion of the SS had made him a powerful enemy in Himmler. Himmler now worked with his subordinate, Reinhard Heydrich, feared chief of the Sicherheitspolizei und SD, the security police and Reich security service, in an effort to discredit the general. They unearthed a report that Fritsch had had a relationship with a rent boy. The charge was groundless, and a military tribunal later exonerated Fritsch, but Hitler failed to reinstate him. Hitler had not wanted rid of either man. He nevertheless used the opportunity of their departure to reorganize fundamentally the highest levels of military command. He reshuffled 12 generals, Blomberg and Fritsch aside, from the Army and Air Force, together with another 51 posts across the two services. The Navy, whose commander-in-chief, Admiral Raeder, had expressed no misgivings about Hitler's plans, was left untouched. Blomberg's old war ministry was abolished and replaced by the Armed Forces High Command, Oberkommando der Wehrmacht, or OKW, with General of Artillery Keitel at its head. Later on, in September 1939, Major General Jodl became chief of the OKW Operation Office, whose task was to advise the Führer on all issues concerning the conduct of military operations. Keitel was a manipulable individual of nervous disposition and limited intelligence. The main characteristics that commended him to Hitler were his enthusiasm, dedication to hard work, and total obedience. Derisive colleagues referred to him as La Keitel, a play on Lackey Keitel. Burkhard Müller-Hillebrand, who served as adjutant for several years to General Franz Halder, the Army Chief of Staff from 1938 to 1942, recalled a particular occasion that said everything about the regard in which Keitel's colleagues held him. He walked past Keitel in the corridor at one of Hitler's military headquarters without saluting, after Keitel's promotion to field marshal. When Müller-Hillebrand asked who the field marshal was and was mortified at his own failure to salute him, Halder told him, "Don't worry, it's only Keitel." Jodl, meanwhile, was highly professional but deeply impressionable. He also drank and ate well, and spending prodigious amounts of time in Hitler's company doing both, he rapidly came to idolize the Führer and fall under his ideological sway. Meanwhile, the army was allotted its own separate command office, the Army High Command, Oberkommando des Heeres, or OKH. Fritsch's replacement as army commander-in-chief was the supine general Walter von Brauchitsch. In the words of Gerhard Weinberg, Brauchitsch was an anatomical marvel, a man totally without a backbone. In fact, the main cause of his abasement was not anatomical, but domestic. Brauchitsch was estranged from his wife and wished to marry again, but his wife was demanding massive financial compensation. When Göring learned of Brauchitsch's domestic circumstances, he saw potential for getting a genuinely pliable commander-in-chief appointed. He recommended to Hitler that he appoint Brauchitsch, buy off his ex-wife, and allow him to marry his mistress. Thus was Brauchitsch personally and financially beholden to Hitler from the moment he became army commander-in-chief. Indeed, his new wife would constantly remind him of how much we owe the Führer. His tenure would be largely marked by a degrading measure of civility to Hitler. Two other new appointees would become increasingly valuable to the regime. One was Major General Bodewin Keitel, Wilhelm's brother, who as chief of the Army Personnel Office played a pivotal role in officer selection. The other was Major Rudolf Schmundt, who as Hitler's Wehrmacht adjutant was instrumental in conveying the Führer's wishes to the army chiefs. In October 1942, by which time he too was a major general, he succeeded Bodewin Keitel. All this left a marginalized, frustrated General Beck as army chief of staff. In contrast to him, none of the new military appointees would attempt to put any kind of brake on Hitler's foreign policy ventures. Nor did the new high command setup augur well for effective planning. Officially, the OKH ran army operations, the OKW broader strategy. But Hitler had arranged matters to ensure that he himself essentially ran everything. The OKW was to function as Hitler's personal military office, issuing his general orders to the various service branch headquarters. Despite its broad strategic official remit, it was not senior to the OKH in any substantive way. On the other hand, staff officers of both the OKH and OKW still enjoyed considerable influence. Hitler had yet to attain the degree of colossal overconfidence in his own military abilities that he would reach during the Second World War. For the time being, this left him extensively reliant on the professionals. Similarly, the service branches still enjoyed considerable leeway in formulating their own plans consistent with Hitler's general orders before sending them back to him for approval. Yet even here there was a downside. However impressive the High Command's general grasp of operational planning might be, and this too had its flaws, its grasp of logistics, intelligence, and, above all, strategy remained as inadequate as it had been during the First World War. Hitler's first foreign policy enterprise of 1938, the Anschluss, saw Austria annexed to the Reich. It proceeded in March, bloodlessly, and with the enthusiastic support of many Austrians. As with the Rhineland, incorporating Austria into the Reich had always been part of Hitler's foreign policy program. As also with the Rhineland, economic motives help explain why Hitler moved when he did. In early 1938, Germany was being compelled to export more in order to balance out the greater volume of imports it needed to help fuel rearmament. Thus, Goering, as head of the four-year plan, was especially proactive in pushing Hitler to annex Austria sooner rather than later in order to exploit its economic resources, particularly its labor. Hitler did not initially wish to see the Reich formally annex Austria with immediate effect, but events forced his hand. In particular, the Austrian Chancellor, Kurt Schuschnigg, anxious to preserve his country's independence, announced a referendum on union with Germany that could conceivably have gone either way. This might have set back the cause of annexation drastically. To preempt it, Hitler resolved on a peaceful but emphatic Wehrmacht incursion into the country. Again, although the annexation of Austria contravened the Treaty of Versailles, neither Britain nor France intervened. The British government in particular believed that the Germans were only going into their own backyard. Generally, the French were less persuaded of the merits of appeasement than the British, but with Britain unwilling to face down Germany, the French lacked alternative candidates as robust alliance partners. Neither a largely ostracized Soviet Union nor a largely isolationist United States could be counted on. But what would most directly hamstring any effort to frustrate Hitler's designs on Austria was the position of fascist Italy and its dictator Benito Mussolini. Italy had been growing closer to Germany since 1936, not least because of the two countries' backing of the nationalist side in the Spanish Civil War. Thus, in 1938, in contrast to previous occasions, Mussolini did not constrain Germany where Austria was concerned. Yet despite all this, neither Hitler nor the Wehrmacht could know for sure how Britain and France would react. Two further unknowables were whether Czechoslovakia would try to intervene and whether the Austrian Federal Army, or Bundesheer, would try to resist. As with the prospective referendum, there were signs that Bundesheer units might jump either way. Because of the circumstances entailed and the scenarios to be considered, the Wehrmacht's move into Austria was highly improvised. This reveals much about the army's shortcomings in 1938, but also about its readiness to address its shortcomings in the light of experience. The army's march plan was completed on 10 March, 5 days before the operation took place. It had to compromise between Hitler's aim of using minimum force so as not to provoke wider international action, the Wehrmacht's need to ensure the safety of its troops, and the short notice with which the latter were to be assembled. Two army corps from Bavaria, together with a motorized force comprising Lieutenant General Guderian's 2nd Panzer Division and motorized Luftwaffe ground troops and SS troops, were placed under the command of the 8th Army. Its forces were to occupy Upper and Lower Austria, particularly the fast approaches to Vienna, while other units were to protect its southern flank by going into the Tyrol. The terrain was tricky, including river crossings and mountain passes. Ground troops and Luftwaffe aircraft alike were not to fire upon Austrian forces unless the Austrians fired first. The last-minute nature of the mobilization spawned a certain amount of chaos. Many of the reservists employed were not suitable. For instance, some artillery batteries complained that their men could not ride horses properly. The autumn 1937 recruits were not yet fully trained. Some were still too weedy for their uniforms to fit them. Many soldiers had not been able to break in their boots properly, and two divisions needed to buy nearly 20,000 pairs of long johns for their men once they reached Vienna. Overall, however, the army's conduct of the invasion was far less inept than some contemporary observers, particularly Winston Churchill, in an effort to embarrass British Prime Minister Neville Chamberlain for indulging Hitler, tried to claim. And the Bundesheer did not open fire. The 2nd Panzer Division, charged with racing ahead as the spearhead towards Vienna, did face considerable difficulties. It was unable to refuel in Bavaria because the Bavarian Army Corps used for the operation had taken all the fuel already. The division found that the Austrian petrol stations provided inferior fuel that overheated motors and burned through cylinder head gaskets. Supply units could not keep up with the spearhead, a legacy of Hitler having started the operation 4 hours earlier than scheduled in order to get in quickly and maintain the element of surprise. the British military attaché in Vienna reported some decidedly dangerous driving around bends and several vehicles with drivers who had forgotten that the Austrians drive on the left-hand side of the road. Despite all this, the German motorized elements reached their objectives. Units acknowledged their failings and their self-critical reports would prove valuable to future operations. Indeed, the fact that our knowledge of the operation's failings is so detailed is due to the comprehensive nature of the reports that the army compiled in its aftermath. The success of the operation and the jubilation, if by no means universal, of the Austrian population were sufficient to banish the anger many senior officers felt over General von Fritsch's shabby treatment. Guderian, for instance, was struck by the crowd's elemental enthusiasm, and the unit diary writer of Panzerjägerabteilung, Panzer Anti-Tank Section 10, wrote that the light in the eyes of the soldiers and the jubilant population showed that this really was recognized as a great historical moment. Annexation brought immediate benefits for the Wehrmacht, and for the German army in particular. Among other things, though absorbing an import-dependent Austria into the Reich caused long-term damage to Germany's balance of payments, an influx of over 400,000 hitherto unemployed Austrians immediately boosted rearmament. Moreover, the German army absorbed the Bundesheer. While numerous senior Austrian commanders disapproved of National Socialism, many of their younger colleagues were avowedly pro-Nazi. The former were men who had been officers in the Royal and Imperial Army of the Austro-Hungarian Empire. They were politically conservative and strongly Catholic. Just prior to and during the Anschluss, however, young pro-Nazi officers removed many of their non-Nazi superiors from their posts. Austria was renamed the Ostmark, Eastern March, and the troops of the former Bundesheer and the new recruits raised by the two new Austrian Wehrkreise would go on to provide valuable manpower for the German army, particularly for its mountain divisions. Britain and France's inertia over the Anschluss emboldened Hitler further. His next target was Czechoslovakia. Invasion would not only secure Germany's eastern frontier and absorb the 3 million ethnic Germans of the country's Sudeten German minority, it would also give Hitler the satisfaction of destroying a functioning parliamentary democracy in Germany's eastern backyard. He also coveted the country's sizable armaments industry. Hitler used the purported grievances of the Sudeten Germans as an excuse to make demands on Czechoslovakia. He insisted that the Sudetenland, which encompassed Czechoslovakia's western border regions, be transferred to the Reich. His real aim, however, was to provoke war with Czechoslovakia. Britain and France initially urged the Czechs to deal with Hitler over the Sudetenland. Hitler, eager for war, now upped the ante by declaring not only that the Sudetenland must be occupied immediately, but also that territorial demands by Poland and Hungary upon Czech territory must be satisfied. This time, Britain and France threatened, if half-heartedly, to intervene on Czechoslovakia's behalf. Hitler claimed that the British and French were bluffing, though he may have done this less because he believed it than because he was trying to fortify the resolve of his generals. Some among the army leadership struck a warning note. Beck, finally seeing an opportunity to head off Hitler's foreign adventuring before it took Germany over the precipice, declared in July 1938 that soldiers' duty had its limits where their knowledge, their conscience, and their responsibility forbids the carrying out of an order. Unfortunately, Beck's fellow generals were now too supine, too swayed by Hitler, or too preoccupied with narrower concerns of rearmament and operational planning to proffer Beck effective support. "Water flows down from the top," Jodl asserted the following month, a remark clearly aimed at Beck. Jodl, like a growing number of generals, believed that senior commanders should obey orders rather than try to do politics. Beck eventually resigned as Army Chief of Staff in August before leaving the Army in October. He then described Hitler as a psychopath through and through, and the increasingly beholden military elite as imbeciles, mediocrities, and criminals. Over time, his opposition to Hitler grew courageous and principled rather than calculating and pragmatic, and he became prominent in efforts to overthrow the Nazi regime. But Beck was not the only military commander who feared the consequences of war with Britain and France in the summer of 1938. While the Luftwaffe enjoyed a production lead over the British and French air forces, that lead was far from unassailable. Invading Britain was out of the question, given the Royal Navy's vast numerical superiority over the Kriegsmarine. Moreover, should the United States proffer economic support to Britain and France, let alone military support, then Germany could not hope to win. Brauchitsch actually conveyed the general's concerns to Hitler, however weakly. For his troubles, the Führer summoned the commander-in-chief to his mountain residence, the Berghof, on the Obersalzberg in Bavaria. Here, in Ian Kershaw's words, Hitler subjected Brauchitsch to such a ferocious high-decibel verbal assault lasting several hours that those sitting on the terrace below the open windows of Hitler's room felt embarrassed enough to move inside. In fact, the summer of 1938 saw the first stirrings of clandestine opposition to the Hitler regime within conservative military, diplomatic, and political circles. It helped that several senior officers had time on their hands following Hitler's reorganization of the high command. More fundamentally, the conspirators, despite their different viewpoints and approaches, shared a growing alarm at the increasingly radical, aggressive nature of the Nazi state, as well as the danger that it could take Germany into war prematurely. With Beck's departure, they placed their hopes in his highly able replacement as Army Chief of Staff, General Franz Halder. Halder, too, was aware of the dangers that Hitler's increasingly reckless foreign policy posed. Indeed, he reportedly remarked to the conspirators, "Ideally, we should blow Hitler sky high in his train a few days after the declaration of war, then put out a report saying he was the victim of an enemy bombing attack." In reality, Halder was an enigmatic, sensitive individual whose viewpoint could change unpredictably according to circumstance. Though he sought to prevent a premature war, he did not seek the overthrow of Hitler as an end in itself. He failed to match his words with practical support for the conspirators, preferring instead to see how the Sudeten crisis panned out. By late September, Hitler was growing reluctantly mindful of his senior military commander's warnings, of Chamberlain's threat to support Czechoslovakia in the event of a German attack, and of Mussolini's offer to mediate. At the Munich conference, Hitler eventually agreed a negotiated settlement by which the Reich would acquire the Sudetenland by peaceful means and the territorial integrity of the rump of Czechoslovakia would be guaranteed, even though the Czechs themselves were not invited to the conference. Most of the army's top-level generals were euphoric that Germany's resurgence as a great power had been further augmented without having had to go to war so soon. Guderian wrote to his wife, "Achieving such a victory without drawing the sword is unprecedented in all history." So far did the generals now fall into line that Jodl confided smugly to his diary, "Hopefully the unbelievers, weaklings and doubters are now converted and will remain so." All talk of a coup attempt fizzled out for the present, and Halder shunned any further machinations to that end. No longer would the anti-Hitler conspirators be able to count one of their number at the highest levels of military command. By the terms of the Munich Agreement, Hitler accepted to settle all future European disputes through peaceful consultation. But the logic of his own ideological and territorial ambitions was such that he could not contemplate sticking to the agreement. He again asserted that Britain and France's threats of war over Czechoslovakia had been a bluff, and that "our enemies are little worms. I saw them at Munich." In October, he called for a fivefold growth in the Luftwaffe, warships built at a faster rate, and large-caliber guns and heavy tanks in increasing quantities for the army. The target date for most of the major arms programs was 1942. But now, partly in response to all too correct reports that Hitler was already getting restless after Munich, Britain and France further intensified their own rearmament. Even more alarmingly for Germany, November 1938 saw the signing of an Anglo-American trade agreement. This did not contain military clauses, even though the Germans convinced themselves that it did, but it certainly suggested that the Americans might render military assistance to Britain and France in the future. The agreement demonstrated that the United States, under President Franklin D. Roosevelt, was finally emerging from its isolationist cocoon, a development that could only hurt Germany. Meanwhile, Hitler's grandiose new armaments targets were already being scuppered by Germany's cash flow crisis and its shortage of foreign exchange. In a speech to the Reichstag on the sixth anniversary of the Nazis coming to power, Hitler railed against Germany's economic straitjacket and damned the shadowy forces that he believed were orchestrating U.S. actions, a theme he constantly reiterated during late 1938 and 1939. He asserted, "If international finance jury inside and outside Europe should succeed in plunging the nations once more into a world war, the result will be not the Bolshevization of the earth and thereby the victory of Jewry, but the annihilation of the Jewish race in Europe." He also claimed that, seeing as the Western powers were denying Germany its right to Lebensraum, the Germans must export or die. To this end, the four-year plan would be reinvigorated with even greater efficiency. Greater efficiency could not, however, reconcile a drive for rearmament with a drive for exports. The upshot for the Wehrmacht was that it could expect severe cuts in its resource allocations. The fall in steel allocations had an especially damaging effect upon the army. By 1939, production of infantry ammunition was dropping alarmingly, a program to produce 1,200 medium tanks and command vehicles between October 1939 and October 1940 had been halved, and a lack of building steel was condemning 300 infantry battalions to sleeping in tents. The need to escape the economic straitjacket and continue rearmament impelled Hitler's audacious foreign policy conduct afresh in 1939. He now sought to reduce the danger of Germany facing two fronts in the event of war. His first step to this effect was to try and persuade Poland to conclude a formal military alliance with Germany. Since the signing of the Polish-German Non-Aggression Pact, Hitler and German military planners had seen Poland as a potentially useful ally against the Soviet Union. Among other things, they noted the Poles' victory over the Bolsheviks in 1920, when the Poles had employed large cavalry formations along lines similar to those Hitler and the army leadership now envisaged for Germany's mechanized formations. Poland was not a formidable military power by any means in 1939, but by setting it against the Soviet Union, Hitler at least hoped to prevent it from allying with France in the event of war. He tested the Poles' goodwill by asking for the return of the Polish corridor, but the Poles, now recognizing Hitler's pledges as not worth the paper they were written on, remained immune to his overtures. It was a desire to put pressure on the Poles that partly impelled Hitler's next foreign policy move. In March 1939, he turned on the rump Czechoslovak state. He accused the Czechoslovak government of border provocations and persuaded the Slovaks, through a combination of carrot and stick, to break away from the state and effectively become a German vassal. He judged correctly that Britain and France would not stand up for Czechoslovakia's territorial integrity if the country had already ceased to exist. He then blackmailed the Czechs, with the prospect of an annihilating aerial bombardment of Prague, into allowing German troops to take over the remaining Czech lands. These were now renamed the Protectorate of Bohemia and Moravia. With all the former Czechoslovak lands under German domination, Germany's geostrategic position vis-à-vis Poland was greatly strengthened. But this time, the British and French finally took a stand against Hitler, pledging support to Poland in the event of a German attack. Chamberlain, in particular, seemed finally to have shed his illusions. Reassured, the Poles continued to spurn Hitler. On the other hand, ruling the Protectorate brought a major increment for Germany's rearmament efforts. It now had access to the vast majority of Czechoslovakia's industrial wealth and resources, including the highly prized Škoda works, which generated prodigious amounts of armaments, locomotives, and machinery. General von Brauchitsch acclaimed Hitler's actions over Czechoslovakia. Halder, however, was more reticent, and Colonel Eduard Wagner, chief of the Army Supply Department in the General Staff, wrote, "We have nothing to fear at present, but soon the bill will be presented to us." But although many generals may have felt a foreboding at the pace of events, they were no longer prepared to voice it openly. The new Protectorate of Bohemia and Moravia was the setting for the first SS and police crimes in occupied Europe, crimes that took place under the army's nose. This is not to say that the army acquiesced willingly. General of Infantry Johannes Blaskowitz, Wehrmacht commander in Bohemia, was a committed Christian who sought to reassure the Czech civilian administration that he would behave with soldierly decency in return for its full cooperation. Given the manner of his later conduct in Poland, there is little reason to doubt his sincerity on this occasion. Nevertheless, the Gestapo arrested 5,000 people in Prague on the night the Germans seized power. In addition, Jewish-owned shops were closed, and the first concentration camp on Czech soil was established outside the capital. Meanwhile, the SS ate into the army's one-time monopoly on the bearing of arms. Indeed, two former army officers, Paul Hauser and Felix Steiner, actually joined the militarized SS during the mid-1930s and would go on to high-level command within it during the war. From 1936, as chief of the Inspectorate of Militarized SS Formations, Hauser altered the unit's structure and training regimes to make them more militarily effective. In the process, he drew on army principles and his extensive army contacts. Thus did Hauser's work not only make the militarized SS more professional, the fact that army officers were willing to help him was an early example of how, over time, the army came to see the Waffen-SS not simply as a rival, but also as a valuable fellow military organization. In August 1938, Hitler finally proclaimed that armed SS formations would be independent of the army. The SS now attempted to persuade potential recruits to join its armed formations rather than the army, with some success. By the end of the winter of 1938 to 1939, the total strength of SSVT and Totenkopf formations stood at 26,000. Although the scale of the army's own expansion still dwarfed this figure, it was a sign of the direction the SS was taking. In May 1939, Hitler declared that the armed SS units would form a combat division of their own in the event of war. By November, armed SS formations would exist to the tune of three divisions, together with a motorized brigade and 50,000 trained reinforcements and replacements. Gottlob Berger, chief of recruitment in the SS main office, now coined the term Waffen-SS, weapons SS, for the first time. Concerned as the army leadership was by these developments, it had lost the power to counteract them. Proving its ideological reliability may have seemed a better means of staying the further slippage of its power, and this would have been one reason why the High Command now intensified its own efforts to indoctrinate the troops. For instance, new OKW schooling brochures were distributed down to the level of platoon commander, and for the first time the High Command attached equal importance to National Socialist indoctrination and weapons training. Moreover, the language used in such material resembled Hitler's now increasingly incendiary language about the Jews. For instance, the article Der Weltkampf des Juden, The Jews' Global Battle, published in December 1938 in Richtlinien für den Unterricht über politische Fragen, Guidelines for Political Instruction, wrote of Jewry's century-old intention to annihilate Germany. That the High Command still had some way to go in radicalizing its officers against Jews is suggested by a report from the U.S. military attaché in Vienna during the days following the Anschluss. The military attaché had described German army officers intervening against the particularly public mishandling of Jews and saving the affected Jews from vengeful party functionaries as frenzied mobs of Austrian Nazis assaulted them. Hitler, too, assumed a more proactive role in officers' education, directly addressing groups at various command levels throughout early 1939, proclaiming that the German people must be educated into fanatical faith in victory. With regard to Poland, meanwhile, Hitler moved from persuasion to coercion. In May, he told the generals to steel themselves for a war over Poland, and not a short war at that. Everybody's government must strive for a short war. The government must, however, also prepare for a war of from 10 to 15 years' duration. The idea of getting out cheaply is dangerous. There is no such possibility. But Hitler was unable to secure the hoped-for military commitments from Italy and Japan. In the event of war, then, Germany faced a potential coalition of Britain and France, with economic and perhaps eventually military support from the United States, together with the Reich's principal ideological enemy, the Soviet Union. In July 1939, however, opposition from Congress forced Roosevelt to postpone a scheme to allow belligerents to buy arms on a cash-and-carry basis. More dramatically, the following month, Nazi Germany astonished the world by securing a non-aggression pact with the Soviet Union. Neither side had any illusion that this was anything more than a temporary truce, but it provided for mutual economic assistance and gave each party the short-term security it needed to pursue its immediate goals. For Germany, the pact at the very least reduced the potential damage that war with Britain and France might wreak. It banished the danger not only of the two-front nightmare that had blighted Germany during the First World War, but also of the crippling shortages that a British naval blockade might inflict. Among other things, the Soviet Union became Germany's main source of imported animal feed, and of 34% of its oil. "The conclusion of this treaty has saved us," announced Colonel Wagner. War with Britain and France over Poland was still a scenario that posed enormous risks. Hitler may have calculated that the Nazi-Soviet pact would deter Britain and France from intervening on Poland's behalf. On the other hand, the United States was temporarily irrelevant and the Soviet Union on benignly neutral terms with Germany. The Luftwaffe was formidable and the German army now the largest in Europe. Moreover, the army's doctrine and training, particularly in armored warfare, were superior to those of its prospective enemies. In view of all this, Hitler may have considered the timing the least worst option for war with Britain and France, a war that, after all, he considered inevitable sooner or later. Either way, on 1 September, Germany invaded Poland, and 2 days later, France, Britain, and the dominions of the British Empire and Commonwealth declared war on Germany. The generals themselves broadly welcomed the Nazi-Soviet pact because it removed the danger of a two-front war. But even with the signing of the pact, many generals remained deeply uneasy at the prospect of confronting Britain and France. In particular, fears of another British naval blockade still loomed large for them. So did the fact that despite all its expansion and improvement, the army was still far less motorized than it needed to be. Only 8% of German industry's vehicle output was allocated to it. But the Nazi-Soviet pact did silence any concerns the generals might otherwise have voiced openly. Furthermore, they now broadly shared Hitler's view that, given the Western powers' clear determination to stifle Germany's great power ambitions, war with them was inevitable sooner or later. On 22 August, Hitler gave a talk to a select group of generals, in which he asserted that Germany must commit to a battle of life and death against the Western powers. By contrast, the generals contemplated war with Poland with unalloyed enthusiasm. Most exuberant of all were the generals of Junker stock, who relished the prospect of retaking their ancestral lands in a final reckoning with the Poles. General of Cavalry Erich Hoepner, who commanded 16 motorized corps, proclaimed, "The Polish question must be solved once and for all." Guderian would regard himself as a latter-day Teutonic knight during the campaign, going so far as to divert the armored spearhead of his 19 motorized corps to liberate his ancestral estate. Manstein, who would be chief of staff to High Command East during the Polish campaign, wrote after the war, "Every time we looked at the map, we were reminded of our precarious situation, that irrational demarcation of the frontier, that mutilation of our fatherland." These were sentiments to which Hitler's 22 August speech also appealed directly and successfully. Between 1936 and 1939, the German army's organization and methods underwent considerable improvement. The Panzer Force announced its arrival emphatically, and the army as a whole refined its way of operating as it accumulated valuable lessons through experience in Spain and Austria. But against the backdrop of the guns versus butter dilemma, the three branches of the Wehrmacht competed for limited economic resources, and the German army enjoyed only limited success in securing the materials it needed to rearm and expand. The international arms race unleashed by the rearmament process exacerbated these problems. It also threatened to go against Germany and thus pushed Hitler towards an accelerated foreign policy timetable predicated on gaining more resources sooner. Hitler's approach to foreign policy, with all the risks of escalation it entailed, did not win the army leadership's universal approval. Nevertheless, the cumulative success of Hitler's foreign policy gambles increasingly eroded opposition within the army. So too did the fact that such gambles brought more manpower and economic resources, and thereby the means of further rearmament, into the German fold. By the summer of 1939, the more cautious and clear-headed among the army's leadership had been sacked or had left their posts. Others resigned themselves to the situation or complied enthusiastically with Hitler's wishes within a new high command structure designed with that very purpose in mind. All this augured poorly for effective military planning, but promisingly, if that is the right word, for the army's ongoing national political indoctrination. By now, the steady ascent of the SS in the military sphere challenged the army's power at the same time as the latter was being eroded from above, and compelled the army to assimilate with the regime even further.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.